answer them for you. But we've also got some sweet raffle prizes, like this Adelaide Giants vintage jersey signed by Nathan Davison and Andrew Scott. They're on the bite right now, on the staff, and they played for the Giants. That's pretty cool. Also, check out this raffle item. Remember Craig Maddox's walk-off single that won the game on Thursday night? It's this bat that he used. It's got the crack in it, and it's signed. So get your raffle tickets today. It's a sweet prize. Enjoy the game, everyone. Have a lot of fun. It's our last regular season home game of the year before we see you in a few weeks. So let's go, Bite. It's time for the first pitch. We've got two first pitchers today. Up first, we've got Cooper Pratt. It's his 10th birthday party today. Can everybody, 1, 2, 3, wish him happy birthday? 1, 2, 3. He plays for Goodwood. He's a pitcher. He's throwing for the first time from the mound today. So everybody clap him in. Clap, clap, clap. Oh, what a pitch. What a pitch from Cooper. A great way to start the game. Up next, we've got a former Major League pitcher, Luke Prokopek. He pitched for the Dodgers, the Blue Jays, and the Reds. He's from South Australia. Everybody, can we get a big clap in for Luke here? Clap, 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 clap. And a great pitch as well. That was the first pitch brought to you by DHL. Let's give it up for Cooper and Luke, everybody.
Good afternoon here. Welcome to Norwood Oval here in Adelaide for game four of this four-game series where the Adelaide Bite are hosting the Melbourne Aces. Adelaide Bite sealed the deal last night. They are the current minor premier and they will sit here and await and see who's going to come here in a few weeks' time and take them on. So not much change here tonight. I'm going to be joined by Jamie McCohen. My name's Andrew Sperling and our great team, the 10th inning, Jim Manning, Peter Wyatt. We're all here. Our last day, our last home series, so you won't have to put up with us for much longer, just another few hours and it'll be au revoir for us, but we've enjoyed every minute of it. I'll go through the Aces lineup with you. Adam Engel will lead off at centre field, Chase Namata will catch, Brad Harmon at shortstop, Kelly Deglan first base, Josh Davies third base, Dylan Cozens will be right field, Josh Hendricks left field, Scotty Wern, DH, Darryl George, second base, Hayden Godbold will take the pill for the Aces. And for the Adelaide Bite, Corey Lyon will lead off and play shortstop. Chan Jong Moon will jump over the other side in second base. Steph Welsh, third base, Tom Bryce, DH, Mitch Denning, centre field, Craig Maddox, first base, Benny Lodge, right field, Tony Vocker, left field, Will Thorpe will catch, and Morgan Coombs will do the pitching duties for the Adelaide Bite. So welcome to Jamie. Great to have you back. Last day for us, Jamie, but we'll make it a good one, hey?
Definitely. It's our swan song, so it's we got to go out on top. Unless we get that deal to play, to commentate for the final series with ESPN, but the contract is still under negotiation. And we're going to see if they're going to meet our demands. And right now we're holding out, though. It doesn't look good.
We're playing hard ball. Our $3.50 an hour is just pushing them over the top. So Yeah, we're doing it tough. But hey, I got a couple of sets of batting gloves to give away today. I got a couple of members' caps to give away. So somehow I got to get my man here next to me thinking of a couple of decent things that perhaps we can use the chat line, the YouTube chat line, for all of we need to get that, hopefully for a couple of locals that, or someone with kids that can do with the batting gloves.
And so if the answers aren't good enough, I'll take the batting gloves myself because I'd need a pair. So there will be competition for him. It's not just going to be handed over.
So Combs immediately tries to get a backdoor slider in that had some nice action on it, but ball one. And he comes again. Goes after a fastball and misses downstairs for ball two. And the chief today is Mark Wilson. It's his last game of ball that he'll be officiating in the near future anyway. He's going to put his nomad cap on and pull a caravan around this beautiful country of ours for a while. So all the best to Mark. Been wonderful. Came here from Victoria. See, I'm not sure, you know, 5 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, and joined the umpiring fraternity and been mentoring Ian Revel, who hopefully might be on his way into this league as an umpire. Andrew Bell at first. We've got everyone out there today. Got Neil Poulton in the outfield and Blake Halligan at third base, and that ball's popped. And that is just foul ball. So Engel went to the right spot, right down the line at left field. But just a metre or two foul. So another absolutely ideal day here. Just 25, 26 degrees, and there's a slider, and Will Thorpe gets half the job done and gets the other half with a nice throw to Maddox. So a K2-3 for Engel.
That Thorpe's pretty handy back there blocking the balls. I was watching him the other night, the Friday night game, and he was blocking everything. Even in warm-ups, he would go down to his knees and block balls, which coach like Brooke Knight's got to put a lot of trust in him after seeing that. So that's why he keeps getting the call, even though he's not the best hitter in the world by any means. But he really works hard back there behind the plate for the pitchers. That pays off in other areas too, like with a man on third base, the pitcher, if he's got a good slider in the dirt, he's not afraid to throw it in the dirt with a man on third base, one out.
And there's Nemata, just hit one dead straight to Lodge at right field, but Chase has been just a constant good swinger of the bat and been doing all sorts of things, picking up some hits and knocking guys in when he gets his little opportunities. And yeah, super impressed with Chase Nemata. Been good behind the dish. And the boys might have, as we were leaving last night, as our pack up, so a good hour or so after the game, and walking past and hearing a lot of screaming and shouting and raucous behaviour coming from the bite change rooms. It was just great to hear, and the boys have really enjoyed it for the moment and realised that they've still got some mountains to climb. So it ain't even anywhere near over yet, and it's a little short sort of thing here that happens. It's you only get one crack at it, three game series, and so somehow on that day or on that weekend you have to really come to play and bring your best ball game to the park. So it's a challenge, Jamie.
It is, yeah. But sometimes it's good. The manager will let him have a little bit of a rest today, you know, give Dixon a rest,
and it's a shot.
Maybe some other guys will be in and out of the lineup pretty quick. He wants to get guys at bats, but you are not going to put too much pressure on the boys today. You let them kind of have a hangover game, possibly, which happens.
A great crack down the line there by Harmon. Stand up double, straight into the left field corner.
And some guys got a lot to prove today as well, like Corey Lyons. He hasn't got that much playing time recently, and still has that average around 300. Just tough to find a spot in that lineup, especially in the infield with Welchie, Moon, and Dixon in there. So, but he can prove something today and maybe get that left field spot come playoff time. It may happen. So he's guys are going to be working hard, putting together some good at-bats.
Absolutely. It's not going to win a championship, you know, based around six or so guys. It's going to be a team effort, and everyone's going to play a part somewhere along the line. So everything needs to be in good nick for the Bite, and it's not going to get any easier for the Aces today to face Coombs. It's been just sensational, and 7-1 record. He's been absolutely outstanding. Today's another day for him, and I think after his couple of innings the other night that maybe he might be on some sort of, you know, four or so inning leash, and we've got plenty of arms. Tolles needs a good workout. Mathis can throw, and Bruneman again can come in and work the end. So it's going to be a tough day at the office for the Aces, but they've started pretty positively here, and Engels, Deglin's got a 3-0 count on him. So again, it might be interesting to see whether, you know, just release the shackles on the Aces too and say, hey, why not have a swing if it's half decent, but he picks a walk.
Good call by Mark there. It's not automatic 3-0. Sometimes they get that pitch about a couple inches off the plate with a 3-0 count, but Mark's got a good eye back there for us today. It's going to be a good game. It's his last game, you're saying, as well, too, so I'm sure he wants to go out with a bang really well. He's going to try to be there for all 300 pitches today, which is a tough job.
So two out, runners on first and second. Davies swings through an outside fastball, strike one.
That's always been the book on Davies. He's swung and missed a lot. I think he's got 190 games played in the ABL and about 170 strikeouts. He's cut him down a bit this year. But years before, it seemed like every game he was punching out once at least. Not afraid to swing it, though. Not many strikeouts looking, I'll tell you that. He lets it rip. Big, strong guy. When he does hit it, you better make sure you're watching it, because it would hurt.
Yeah, leading the Aces in average. So yeah, just as you sort of mentioned, that he has corrected a couple of things. And hey, he's still, you know, in terms of this level, still, you know, not an old stager. And he strikes out there. So Adelaide Bite get rid of the Aces in the top of the first without any score being put on the board. So we'll be back and we'll see you at bottom one in a sec.
SA Power Networks employs more than 2,000 South Australians and delivers electricity to around 840,000 customers. We don't make electricity, and we don't sell it either. What we do is deliver electricity to your home. From the Rundle Lantern to our airport, hospitals, schools and traffic lights, power is vital to the function of our state. That's why our team is on call 24/7, rain, hail or shine, to respond to any emergency. Plus, we're taking the initiative to ensure that everyone can access information about their power supply however and wherever they like. We also foster vital connections through more than a dozen community sponsorships. At SA Power Networks, we're working with you to
Getting things underway here in the bottom of the first inning for the Adelaide Bites. Shortstop, number 32, Corey Lyon.
So both teams have chucked things around a little bit. Brad Harmon comes back into the Aces lineup and straight back into that familiar number six position that he plays so brilliantly. Deglan at first. Wern's going to DH. George goes to second base and Lyon just leans back on that and tears it into centre field. Hard turn round first. So a base hit, first pitch, Corey Lyon.
Yep, second pitch. He's definitely making second a pitch, case sorry. For himself to get in those finals lineup. Let's see what he can do. And what's up with, what's Moon wearing on his face?
He got a complete white
zinc out.
Zinc.
That's something the Asians really like to take care of their skin. They're known for that. And they do have nice skin most of the time, in my opinion. So he's doing what he can to avoid that Aussie sun.
He's a character. He is a real character. I think it's one of the real fantastic things to see the integration of players and nationalities and teams come together. And Chan Jong is very shy and he's just, etc. But no longer he's rollicking with the group and being a practical joker. And he swings through that one 0-2.
Yeah, humor is a great way to communicate when the language isn't always there. Universal language, humor. Funny's funny.
You bet.
I reckon the Bite are going to handle Gotbold pretty good. I mean, that's not Adelaide Bite bias. That's just my opinion as a commentator here, seeing the stats that he's put up so far this year. But, yeah, young guy, normal stuff, nothing too spectacular. Got the same amount of walks as strikeouts, which is in a good ratio. So if the Bite can be patient and get some good pitches to hit, they should be able to do a lot of damage today and get a complete sweep. This would be their second sweep of the season.
Mm-hmm.
Why not? Yeah, you want to go into the finals with a lot of momentum and a sweep here, and then beat them up next weekend as well. Would have them feeling really good for the finals.
Yeah, it's going to be a big weekend next week in Melbourne. I read the little interview they did with Huber, and it was a great interview. And yeah, got a really fantastic days at the ballpark, and it'll be Justin's last game on Saturday, I believe. So all the Melbourne people, you get on down and say good day and your last hurrahs in a playing sense to one of the champions of Australia, Justin Huber.
He's going. Ooh. Did like a fake steal there. He wanted to get the jump, but didn't get what he wanted from a jump perspective, and decided to turn around and go back. Full count, great time to run. Brooks definitely going to send him. That's something Corey's got to show Brookie can do. You know, when he puts the sign on, you got to go. Trust the hitter to make contact with a 3-2 count or a 2-2 count even and go. Good. He's off here, and I love seeing that. Even on a Sunday game after they beat him up with three games in a row, coming out firing. First guy gets on, stealing. First at bat, let's go. Yeah. He turned like he wanted to go again, but shut it down. He's got to just trust it. Don't worry about getting the most perfect jump. And just go here. Trust Moon not to strike out, which is a lot to ask. Moon isn't afraid to rack up a couple punches as well.
Yeah, Namada's got an excellent arm, so it certainly brings a double play as a possibility. But he has got off and got running, and exactly what Jamie said. Just believe that your hitter will protect you and do the job.
Corey's on showcase right now. He's fighting for that spot. Faka's only hitting about 100. or 150. Corey's hitting around 300. Vaca's definitely the better outfielder, I guess. That's why Brooks going with him so far. But you need hitters. And Corey's showing him he can hit and showing him he can run the bases now, too, and be that smart base runner, be wise above his age, you know, which is another thing. Brooke might want to go with the experience over the young talent.
So Moon picks a walk.
See, stuff like that. Like, Brooke doesn't see that. Corey is walking back to the base there. Got to know the count, full count, ball four. Take off to second. See Brooke gesture with his hands like, oh, come on, what are you doing, kid?
Third baseman number 22, Stephen Welch.
He'll get it, though. He'll work the kinks out. Can't argue with that line drive single he had.
Yeah, and it'd be an absolute touch and go with regards to the outfielding of the two, because Corey has done a wonderful job, too, when he's in his opportunities. He's shown that he's a real talent and just athletic, and he can play the position maybe a little bit over. You know, misses a cutoff here or there, which, again, just those little things, and it mightn't mean much, but in a tight little game, it just, all of those little things add up, and generally the team with the best pitching, best defense will win most games.
Yep. Oh, that's got to be frustrating for the Melbourne coach here as well. First two guys get on. That Moon guy's got 41 strikeouts, and you can't give him a free pass. You got to make him swing the bat, because if he does, he's probably going to miss it a good portion of the time. You know, the numbers don't lie that much. And he also can hit it really far sometimes as well, but you make him earn it. And now he's got to face these four or five big lefties in a row. Welch, Bryce, Denning, Maddox, with two guys on and nobody out.
And they're moving. And they've successfully completed a double steal. Namada,
I think,
was caught in two minds there. Perhaps he wanted to sit with that pitch as well and, you know, get the called strike. So, yeah, just a little.
Russell Davies didn't even, Josh Davies didn't even move, though.
Okay, so no one.
The coach should ask him how much he paid for his ticket today. Guess he didn't hear it or something. Or maybe he just thought he got way too good of a jump to even think about covering third, but I don't think that was the case. There was a play there at third to be had. And that's just how the season for Melbourne's going this year.
So 2-2, none out. Runners on second and third with Welch in stellar form. Gets one in, and you know the temptation would be there, because he's relished these opportunities and sees another couple of RBIs just sitting there for him. So he'd be extremely eager, but just got to be patient. It'll all come. So Godbold comes in again and misses. So Welch walks.
Could be a short day for this Melbourne pitcher. Not saying I told you so, but it doesn't look good for him so far. How much? I wasn't here the past couple days. How much bullpen arms do they have? How many bullpen arms do they have today?
Well, I'd be.
Couple of guns in the arsenal that they can blow out today. Last game of the series, they probably did get worked pretty good last night in a 10-3 loss. So they can't be that fresh. Might be one of those games where you see a position player pitch.
Well, they did last night. Davies finished and George had a throw the night before. And, you know, I'm thinking that Buckle might have a little left in him. Maybe Uvoli, I think he's eligible. So, you know, the
Uvoli.
Yeah,
it'd be cool to see him out again.
Yeah. Oh, Bryce gets one off the handle, or just a little blooper, but trouble. So there's a double play on a ball that did look like it would have sunk, but boy, Engel showed great read on that and really got on his bite, because legitimately that ball probably should have hit the turf. But that was an excellent play on a flare to shallow center right.
Yeah, good jump on that ball, and didn't have to dive for it, but was running full speed through it. And Moon needs to reacquaint himself with the tag up rule. It's been around this game for 100 years. And yeah, he had no doubt in his mind that he was scoring on that. But I don't know what he was looking at. I mean, Corey wasn't running. And you got to be looking at something. You see, I mean, he's not going to run Corey down. So he's got to be, I don't know, eyes on the ball, eyes up, eyes on the field, somewhere. And he just got himself a lot of luck there. Double play, pitcher's best friend, no matter how it comes, infield, ground ball, double play, or base running mishap.
So Denning, be ashamed to waste what started as a very promising start.
Yeah, sometimes that pitcher can think everything's going against him, and then all of a sudden he gets a play like that and says, hey, this game isn't that hard. Maybe I can settle in and get through it.
Yeah. So runners in the corners. Pitched outside and a delayed steal. And they're going to go for it first and third, but line is cold at the plate. So the Aces, with some good first and third defense, get the job done and retire the bite in the bottom of the first. They can't put one on the board after a very promising start. We'll see you back in a sec.
The Adelaide Bite would like to thank SA Power Networks, our naming rights sponsor. SA Power Networks are a proud South Australian company that plays a leadership role in community involvement and has a proud reputation as a significant corporate citizen. Top of the second inning, the right fielder, number 18, Dylan Cousins.
Look at this massive unit at the plate. What's he weighing in at?
I think he's a good 107. Sorry, that's, 107. Kegs.
That's what he must carry him around all day.
Got in good nick.
And that's a hard 107 kilos.
Yeah, planted one last night. I just saw it off the bat, but then couldn't quite pick it up. It was smoked. So he got a different job today against the funk of Coombs to be patient and wait, and he whipped through that little sinking fastball outside. Tall and big, 198 centimetres, so, you know, we're talking legit 6'7". And yeah.
6'7", probably 250 pounds of American muscle.
Swinging, what, a big 35 inches, you think?
Or at least. Coombs doesn't want to come into him just yet. Kind of nibbling away at that outside. Sometimes these big guys got the long swings, though. It's a lot of moving parts he's got to get going, and there are going to be some holes there that Coombs is going to try and expose.
And he's been terrific like that. I've really been a big rap for him because he's been patient and he hasn't swung at bad pitches. when it's there to have a good crack at. He's had a decent shot, but he's picked, I would have thought, 4 or 5 walks this weekend. Where is he? There's 2. A couple of strikeouts, but a double there. And there's another couple of walks, and there's another one. So, yeah, 5 walks. So he's trying to get the job done as well and give his team, try to build an innings and get some decent numbers on the board, because it's been a lot of ones and etc. Mentioned right before pre-series that there'd been a little lack of production in RBIs that obviously just haven't either been able to get enough on and chances to knock them in.
Sometimes it just seems so hard to score runs. Those bases seem like they're so far apart. Not just 90 feet, they seem like they're 500 feet apart, and it's just so hard to get around and get your team scoring runs. And that's the kind of year it's been for the Aces in some ways, even though their offense hasn't been that short. Pitching's been their main problem, huh? They got a lot of home run hitters on that team. Not too many high averages, but they can score some runs.
Yeah, I think their bullpen definitely has been
suspect.
An issue,
to say the least.
But Hendricks, who again in amongst some strikeouts, and see him really stepping in the bucket at the moment. You can see his front footmark there is not where it should be. Really conscious of Morgan's ability to be able to throw sliders straight at him, and he's stepping in the bucket, but hanging in there right at the moment. Cousins is off. Will Thorpe's got a chance at him, but
the guy can move.
Yeah, he stole one the other night. He caught Adelaide unaware and then got picked off at his next try. But he's not shy, and you could see him twitchy over there. He was on the move, yeah. And it was good timing, because it was, as it worked out, it was Morgan's very gravity slider, so it took an age to get to Thorpe, which didn't help his cause.
That is a very unorthodox hitting style we're seeing. But he keeps himself in the lineup nonetheless with it. Makes enough contact to be in the back end of the lineup. So hats off to him. I knew one guy that used to hit like that. It was a big-time prospect for the Milwaukee Brewers, Salome. Jesus Salome or something, and he was stepped out, but led the Southern League in batting average 1 year, hit like 350. Dominican guy from New York City, Bronx. And there's some big leaguers that step out and hit like that as well, but who was one of them? Jim Thome, he's kind of a bucket stepper in a way.
There's a pop by Wern, first pitch, straight to Welsh, third base. He happily accepts it. Two out. Boy, hitting is not an exact science, and so many cliches. It's streaky and it's contagious, and I think there's probably been the part of the Adelaide lineup that we've discussed, and with Dixon and the boys that have been at the top, that have really just got things underway with a, you know, slam on off the fence, second pitch to, you know, fire everyone up. And it, you know, it does become then that you want to step into the batter's box and have a little play yourself.
It really is contagious, and pitchers don't pitch as well out of the stretch sometimes, and there's holes opening up when you get guys on first base. And guys in double play depth, those 5-6 hole and the 3-4 hole, they get a lot bigger. I remember playing on a good team. We had a guy hitting like 350 in front of me. And he was fast, and he hit a lot of singles. And he'd be on first base, and that 4-3 hole would look massive. Because then the second baseman's playing closer to second for the double play, and the first baseman's holding him on. And if he can steal, the pitcher's going to throw more fastballs. And a guy's on first base, so he's definitely not going to walk you and get two guys on base. So, yeah, in a sense, I mean, it sounds cliche to say it's contagious, but it is. It makes it easier. The more guys that are hitting, the more tired the pitcher gets. And sharks smell blood in the water as well. So, that pitcher starts to feel like a victim a little bit. He is going to get victimized in a way and beat up on. And that's just how hitting is. But, yeah, there's a lot of other cliches, too, that are silly that you hear all the time that means something from one guy, but means something else to another guy. Staying back, keeping inside the ball. Some guys say don't stay inside the ball that much. Get the head out. You know, if you're getting the head out, you're not staying inside the ball that much. So things like that. It's not an exact science. Just like you said, different things work for different people.
Absolutely. And I think we see all the different styles, but this sort of seems to be and exactly what Don spoke about with Maddox, is that when it's time to be in that good position, is that Maddox, regardless of how he starts and hands up in the air, he ends up in good position, and Lyon's going to have to attack and get one off, and he flings it over the top of Maddox. So Cousins will score, and the Aces break the early deadlock and get one on the board for a wild throw by Corey Lyons.
Hopefully he can shake that one off and be ready for the next one, because it's going to be a long day. They're going to get 9 innings of baseball in. Coombs is going to get you some work out there as well, Corey. So shake that one off and be ready for the next one. End this inning with a nice play here. That was a tough play. One of them slow rollers, guy moving quick down the line and in that 5-6 hole, running away from your target. Tough play to make for anybody. You'd like to see him not give the run though away with the high throw, but when you're trying to do special things, sometimes bad stuff happens.
Not that you would expect it at this level, but you know, it'd be worse if he was a bit shy to go in and get it and afraid of making an error. So
yeah, he went after it.
He went after it, all right. And interesting that you know, Moon has been the regular shortstop, and you know, pivots are pivots. It's easy to say that, but they're both, I'm sure, Chan Jong would understand the position, and not too bad for it to go over the other side and have an understanding of what.
Here we go. Get that third out.
And he does. So the Aces get on the board. And they lead it 1-0 as we will move to the bottom of the second. See you back here in a moment.
The second inning, Melbourne able to score a run there. The score is 1-0 as we head to the bottom of the second.
All right, Bite fans, we've got two junior Bite fans here. We've got Lily right here, and we've got Ryan, and they want to do the dizzy bat race. So, you know how it works. Forehead on the bat.
SA Power Networks employs more than 2,000 South Australians and delivers electricity to around 840,000 customers. We don't make electricity, and we don't sell it either. What we do is deliver electricity to your home. From the Rundle Lantern, to our airport, hospitals, schools, and traffic lights, power is vital to the function of our state. That's why our team is on call 24/7, rain, hail, or shine, to respond to any emergency. Plus, we're taking the initiative to ensure that everyone can access information about their power supply however and wherever they like. We also foster vital connections through more than a dozen community sponsorships. At SA Power Networks, we're working with you to deliver the power you need, now and in the future.
Leading off here in the bottom of the second inning for the Adelaide Bites, center fielder number 17, Mitch Denning.
So Mitch Denning back in the box after the failed first and third attempt, so he leads things off in the bottom of the second, strike one.
Yeah, let's see if Goldman has to make a good pitch this inning. Last inning he kind of got out of that without making a good pitch. Walked some guys and gave up a hit and almost a bloop single, which was probably a good pitch to Brycey. But other than that, the Bite basically just ran themselves out of that inning. But that's what you're going to see from Brooke Knight sometimes. He is going to take chances and be aggressive and work those first and third plays. And he's especially going to do it now to see if it's going to work come finals time, you know. It may be a weapon that he needs in a game against the Heat. And he wants to see if it's going to work now. If it's not going to work now with Corey, or it may work with Moon. We'd like to steal a home. Didn't work with Moon, but he's trying stuff out. So look forward to an exciting final series with a lot of aggressive baseball, because that Perth Heat team also likes to be aggressive. Brooke coached there for a couple years, and they do embrace that style of baseball. That's why Brooke Knight fit in so good there with the Perth Heat, was able to win a couple of championships.
So is that your tip? Going to be a Bite Heat final.
Oh, did I just give it away? I actually do think it's going to be that. I think that Perth Heat side is real strong, a lot of experience, and they're used to winning. They expect to be there, and that mental confidence really helps when it comes to baseball. So, Goldbaum finding himself another full count. You don't want to mix in too many three-ball counts, and I think he's got about two or three already, having faced five hitters.
Yeah, we've got our first set of batting gloves and members' cap to give away here, and I want to know your favourite player, favourite Bite player. Doesn't have to be your traditional, you know, reason why that he hits a lot of home runs. I want something a bit interesting, a bit different. So give us on your chat line here, give us your favourite Bite player, and give us a quick little reasons why, and we'll give our first prize away. So another walk there. And Willie's been a bit fortunate. Again, Maddox. It's hard to know exactly what style of pitching would suit Craig the best, but at the moment he's just a little out of sorts.
Did get that walk-off in the first game, but after that it's been kind of flat, you're saying?
Well, even that walk-off was
a bloop single.
Yeah, an inch under his fists, and it was only his strength that barreled it up the middle, but that it does not matter 1 ounce. He swung the bat and did the job and got the win. But he really hasn't squared one up or hit one powerfully for a while. You know, it only takes a couple, doesn't it? Just such a sensational feeling to feel that right off the middle of the bat. You just know it, and it's a great feeling. And if you knew the answer and how easy it could be, everyone would be doing it. So it's a tough old gig. You got to really apply yourself, and he checks swings.
You gotta do, the one advice I have for that is you just got to do it a lot. Good hitters hit all the time, and I'm telling that to my club team now, and I'm trying to practice what I preach as well and just take a lot of swings. As long as the body can do it, get your 100 swings in a day with a live ball. It's nothing to it but that. There's no tricks you can teach guys, you know, oh, keep that hand in that position or step at that time. You know, the timing figures itself out the more swings you take, and the body just seems to grasp it subconsciously the more swings you take, and you just find yourself in a rhythm and you find yourself on the barrel, and eventually those base hits start coming. Not for me though, but for some people it looks easy after they do it a lot.
He's lifted that one right out straight away center field with angle back to the warning track, takes the catch. So not far off for Maddox, and again he really didn't quite get it, but he's a strong little individual and he's got some serious pop.
He does, got a powerful set of legs on him from the years of catching and workouts. He is a professional in every sense of the word. That's what he does. He plays about 100, 150 games a year. Baseball is his life. And his body and his swing and the way he goes about himself, you can tell he is a pro.
Yeah, he sure is, and he's played a couple of positions that perhaps not totally familiar with, and made a sensational play last night. A hard hit ball and sprawled and snaffled it and sent it over to Hooper for a bit of PFP, but it was a high class play. He is an excellent ball player. We've mentioned he's going to be a factor because of that X factor perhaps Steel. That he has got.
Denning might be taking it a bit easy today. He has been playing a lot of baseball, working hard. He's got a big body. It's tough for those big guys to steal all the time, but he may be running soon. Quick snap throw there by the Hawaii native in Numata, Pearl City, Hawaii. I got to spend 3 months in Hawaii a couple years back playing that Hawaii Winter Baseball League, and that is a beautiful place. So aloha to all the Hawaii listeners if you're tuning in and watching your boy play over here in Australia. But yeah, that's a great place to live.
Ooh, and Vocket's got a hold of that. Right back to the wall. Gone. So Tony Vocket steps up to the plate. Says, I've been promising to do this for you for a little while. And I like the look of that one. And he smacks it over the center right wall for a two-run shot.
Been waiting on that for a while, and you watch him take BP, it's a really powerful quick swing. He's not the biggest guy in the world, but it seems like he hits about every other ball out in batting practice, and Brooks just been waiting on it to come, and he's been sticking with him, and it may pay off come finals time. And there's Vaca making a case for himself to stay in that lineup, even though the average isn't quite there, but the sample size is still pretty small with Vaca. And Brooks counting on that. He sees that the sample size is small, and he trusts the swing still. And he trusts the instincts. He trusts the speed and the know-how with the outfield play. Man, Davies is watching this game from third base, it seems like. Not very interested today. Might have had a nice night on the town, possibly, but that's the second time he's kind of just sat back at third base and watch the game go by. Can't blame him. I'm having a great time watching the game as well, so he may just be taking it easy like we are up here in the booth. What do you think of that, though, Spurlo? That's pretty tough, huh, from a professional side. 0-2 in two innings there with Davies without an attempt.
But it might be deemed as harsh, and obviously for the people back in Melbourne town thinking, hey, get off their back. But, you know, there's just been things occurring like that. And then, of course, Thorpe hit a tough two bouncer down the line that would have taken a real A-grade third baseman to have handled.
And tough chop, yeah.
Tough chop, and he wore it on the arm, knocked it down. So Will Thorpe gets on via a base hit, but exactly the same thing. Will Thorpe shouldn't be in the batter's box. He should be out because a little pop fly that landed 6 metres away from the catcher or 12 metres away from the catcher, and same last night, a ball that went down the first baseline in a bit of foul territory and wasn't taken, and he gets a double and scores another run. And just all the, you know, a guy like Gobbold is going to need every little out taken as Lyons flies that ball to centre field and taken by Andrew. But via a two-run knock from Vocket, it's a 2-1 scoreline as we'll move to the top of the third. We'll see you back here in a minute.
The scoreline is now 2-1.
Fast approaching, and so too is the Australian Baseball League Championship Series. Who will claim the Shield in 2015? Find out live on ESPN and MLB Network.
Barber makes the call, it's all over. And the Perth Heat have done it.
Leading off here in the top of the third inning for the Melbourne Aces, the catcher number 16, Chase Umaga.
So welcome back, beautiful Norwood Oval here for Sunday matinee baseball. Adelaide Bite leading at 2-1 in the top of the third, and someone who you wouldn't even consider talking about effort levels and application is this Chase Umaga, solid as a rock, contact hitter,
smooth lefty stroke. Oh, came out of his shoes there. That's tough. That's what Coombs will do to you, though. Have you grinding your teeth down, have you spitting. So frustrating. Doesn't look like it would be that tough, but once you get in that box, he puts you in the twilight zone and you're not really sure what's going on.
Coombs comes again, and there's that gravity pitch, but Umaga just, and there's Vocca out at left field.
Kind of got a bad read on that ball. Didn't come in too hard right away, but made up for it with a lot of effort and took the diving catch. That's good to see, you know. Never giving up. Got the bad read. Oh, it's going to be a lot more shallower. I'm still going to go after it full speed and get it. Having himself a pretty good inning here. The home run and the diving catch there. That's why Brooks sticks with him. No slow speed with that Vocca guy. He's 100% all the way. Melbourne should take note of that and see the effort level.
Hard hit ball. Oh. Corey Lyon goes down for a backhand play and it shoots through the mitt. So a tough one to score there, whether just a simple E6 or too hot to handle, but you'd be thinking at this level an E6, unfortunately for Corey.
To Corey's credit, he hadn't played that much shortstop this year at all, but as a bench guy, he's got to make sure he's getting work in elsewhere, either with his club team or in practice or BP. He's got to be getting the 100 ground balls every time he comes out here, which is tough to do. But, you know, on nights that he's not starting, when I used to not start, I used to go really hard in BP, shagging balls in the outfield, getting my work in. Those are your free days where you can really test yourself and not worry about being fresh for the game. So I'm not saying Corey isn't getting that work in. He probably is. But it's not showing so much right now. He's had a couple of rough plays, but a lot of game left, and he can bounce back. Shortstop's the hardest position on the field, and I look up to those guys that catch and play shortstop, because that's a long throw, a lot of range you got to cover, you're involved in every pitch basically in both of those positions, so you got to be on your toes all the time.
So Coombs piffs one over to first to keep Harmon in check. Good situation here for Deglan. Not that you would suggest perhaps this is totally his style of pitching. He's going to have to really hold himself back. He's a back-to-front guy. Coombs, as we've spoken about many times before, just sets you up with his sliders and throws that fastball when you least expect it.
That's right. Any pitch, any count, any arm angle, any cadence to the plate, he'll go the high leg step, the short slide step. the high fast one, the low fast one.
And Deglan hits that hard down the first baseline and it shoots through Maddox's glove. He rolls Harmon around to third. So a base hit, Kellen Deglan.
Those are always scary when you're playing first base or even running at first base and you get that big lefty stick up there. It's pretty much dead pull. That's when first base turns into the hot corner. Normally third base is called the hot corner, but when Deglan's up, that whole right side's the hot corner. He swings a quick bat. And here's a little chance for redemption for Davies coming up here. See if he's a bit more interested now. You reckon if he punches out here, Tommy Thompson's got to tell him maybe to take a seat and give somebody else that's a little bit more interested a chance. You know.
And there's that slider and he fights it off, knocks it into his team's dugout.
Might have been a hit and run there. First and third is a good hit and run time. You get a good chance to score that run. With runners moving, all you need is a ground ball, and you avoid the double play with the hit and run, so you don't get that inning double play.
So one out, runners in the corners. And again, he comes in and he pops it. Maddox wants it and takes it. Moon with his white face right behind him.
Yeah, it's just not Davies' day today. That's the one thing you don't want to pop up to the infield there. Ground ball probably scores a run, ties the game. Fly ball deep enough, ties the game. Anything but a pop up to the infield or a strikeout. You're in business. He's quick enough to avoid the double play a lot of times too, so just not his day. Probably wishes he had a tunnel he could go into and smash a couple of bats, but he probably doesn't. Probably can't afford that either. Wood bats are costing about $140 a pop now, so. Especially from Sam Bats, the ABL sponsor. Shout out to them. That is a quality maple bat that Barry Bonds started using back in the mid-2000s. Jose Canseco as well. A lot of home runs have come out of those Sam Bats.
Mm.
They are what I call the Cadillac of maple bats. They're just nice. Nicely done. They're not those new models like the Max Bats are newer and flashier and the Marucci's with the cool name and the cool designs. But Sandbat's always been around. They're the first one. Ooh.
And the boys are a bit shabby because that was a line drive straight at Lodge. Harmon scores. Deglan scores on a single to Lodge that was a nice hard line drive and bounced about 2 metres in front of him and got a hard skid and it just blasted through him and went to the fence. So good piece of hitting there by Cozens. Again, just sat and waited, didn't try to crush it, just get good bat on it. Slam one out the right field.
Yeah, he hits those risers that you think might get to you, but that one didn't hold up enough to get to Lodge. And to his credit, he did get a good read, but then you get stuck with that in-between hop. And he did get a body on it, but the way Cousins hits it so hard, even if whatever it hits, it's going to bounce off. It's not going to die. His ball, he hits a live ball, as they'd say. You know, it's got a lot of action on it. It's going to bounce around. It doesn't just hit and fall and stop. With a big guy like that putting a lot of pressure on that ball. So Lodge got a bit unlucky there. Oh, we almost got a foul ball there. Came straight back. I guess there is a small window of opportunity for us to get one, but it's, the stars got to line up. For one to sneak all the way up here. But I tell you what, if we got one up here, these mitts would be ready. Got a lot of computer equipment up here, so everybody's got to kind of sell out for the technology here and put a hand on it.
Oh, and there's that gravity slider. I tell you, it's to be a tough pitch because you would just have to take it, pick that front foot up and tiptoe it about 7 times before it got to you, and timing would be super difficult. But the aces whack a couple on the board, and it's good enough for him to take a lead, a one-run lead into the bottom of the third. A 3-2 ball game. Back in a flash.
Brett, there's something we take very seriously. Delicious, tender steak, just how you like it. Slow cooked for 18 hours, the traditional prime rib steak is still king. Seriously, great steak for serious steak lovers. Oh, yeah. It's much less picturesque without a catch in the light. The horizon tries, but it's just not as kind on the eye.
And folks, we also have a birthday announcement today. Happy birthday to Nick Bayless, a longtime helper here at the Bite. Leading off here in the bottom of the third inning for the Adelaide Bite, second baseman number 7, Chan Jong Moo.
So CJ Moon leads the bottom of the third, and it's a casual Sunday here, obviously, and everyone's just a little slow out of the boxes. And
I don't know about that white face either with the glare and stuff. Usually they put the black stuff around the eyes for the glare. Maybe Moon would go with the white face and then still put eye black on. That might work better. But then he'd look like a panda bear. That'd be pretty funny. You have eye black on, or sunglasses. You may be wearing sunglasses, so it is kind of a panda bear look. Interesting.
And he picks a walk.
Is that his second walk? That's good to see. Good to see him being patient, not punching out, chasing bad pitches. Getting deep into some counts and having to pay off and getting the free pass. Walks kill. And got. Lee has been racking them up.
Yep, that's 11 hitters up and 4 walks.
Godbold, not Gottlieb. Yeah, Godbold has been racking them up. 4 walks already in the third, so something's bound to break soon. You get that bend but don't break, and aces certainly have bent. And they may be about to break. There's only so many walks a pitcher can have, especially if he doesn't have that lights out stuff. I remember seeing A.J. Burnett throw a no-hitter with 9 walks, but he's throwing 95 to 100 miles an hour back then. He was about 24 years old, pitching for the Marlins. And Gottbold does not have that stuff to get a lot of punch outs. So the more balls hit in play, the more walks. It's not a good combination. Something's going to break soon. Leadoff walks always score. I think it's like 100% of the time. Was the stat behind that?
Or seriously?
Yeah, 100% of the time, walks, leadoff walks score. No, that can't be, but it seems like it sometimes.
So Rod's asking about the playoff rules with regards to roster, and I'm sorry, my great man, I'm sort of not able to categorically give you a huge answer there, but the only thing I can tell you is that I keep seeing Virgil Vasquez on the team sheet for Adelaide, and they're still convinced that he's going to throw in the championship series. So that's about the only wild card that I can sort of tell you. Apart from that, I would say that they have to comply with the rules that have been set the whole season. That won't be open slather. You've still got your 5 Aussies on your roster and a couple of starters. Or maybe that might change, perhaps, with the 3-game series, but
you'll see. And sometimes those roster rules can be somewhat arbitrary and shifty as the season carries on, with tough decisions having to be made, with, you know, guys getting sent home and injuries and stuff. So David Foster, the GM of the league, allows Ben Foster. Who's Dave Foster?
Is he the wood chopper?
Could be. But, yeah, Ben Foster allows some leeway with those rules just to keep the competitive balance of the league up to standard. So you may want to send an email to Ben Foster and ask him what the official playoff roster rules will be. See if Moon tries to start running. I don't think the aces like him running that much, but the bite don't let other people tell him when to run, and that's what Burke's going to be consistent about. He's not going to – you can't let the other team say you can't run on us or we're going to hit you, because then you look soft, and a championship team is not soft. Oof. We went about halfway there and turned around.
Second-guessed himself three times. I think he spun the wheels and thought he might have been picked off, and yeah, got halfway and came back. So we got 90 feet, but unfortunately 45 up and 45 back. So he remains on first, and yeah, you just sort of know that the wheels aren't exactly turning the way things have been. Whether it's just a little bit of a mental letdown or whatever, because normally we would have stolen this base, and as Corey would have gone before as well. We've been very aggressive and we've had our chance. I mean, he's very slow to the plate and throwing a lot of off-speed pitches. So
true. There is a lot of off-speed pitches, and off-speed pitches are great to run on.
He goes against.
Shouldn't even.
He should get there comfortably, and he does.
Good jump there, and he just finally decided to go. And maybe not the best jump in the world, but it was good enough. And he's got the good speed to get there. That's what Brooke wants to see. You know, when he puts a sign on, just go. And you've seen a lot of those second guesses. Maybe it's Godbolder. Maybe he's got like that quick step where you think it's going to be really quick, but he starts real quick, but then ends up after that initial taking that left foot off the ground, he kind of slows it down. Even though initially it's quick, and then he slows down and still makes it a 1-4, 1-3 to the plate, which is good enough to run on, slow enough to run on. But I've been tricked by those guys. They pop up so quick and you think you don't have the jump, but they eventually slow down and don't have that 1-1 to the plate like a Shane Lindsay used to do. Golly, that guy used to have a 0.91 to the plate, throwing 95 to 100 miles an hour, built like a door. He was tough to run, but you kind of just cheat on him because he didn't have to pay attention to runners. One of those typical closer guys that didn't have to pay attention to running and just strike everybody out. Is he still playing?
Good question.
He brings it. He comes after hitters.
As you said, he was a big, big lad. There's Bryce. Just knocks one up the middle and it gets under George's glove. Engels collected it. Fires to home, but it hits the backstop. And Bryce wheels around to second. So Brycey with a single up the middle scores a run.
Engels threw a bomb there. That hit about halfway up the backstop. Sometimes on a Sunday, you just want to show off that arm a little bit for the scouts. Maybe that's what Engel was doing there. He almost threw that to us, brother.
Yeah, he did. And that's
close.
Again, remember in the outfield, especially when the one that you had to charge and had a lot of forward momentum, it was very difficult to bring the ball down. You often threw it over the top of your cutoff, and that's why your little chop steps and to try to slow yourself down and get a better throw off, even though sometimes you obviously don't have the chance when it's a boom boom and you got to get rid of it.
That's just one of the reasons, though, why Melbourne's probably at the bottom of the ladder. I mean, mistakes like that. Now you just put the winning run on second base on a slow, slow hit ball up the middle that Bryce barely got through. It wasn't hit hard. Didn't get to the center fielder right away. And the fast wheels at second base with Chan Moon, you're not going to have that much of a chance to throw the guy out at the plate there. You guys got to cut your losses, hit the cutoff, and not let Bryce get into scoring position. But why not? Who cares? They're out of it anyways. Just let it rip.
Denning, who can nearly see his mind ticking over in there, he's being sort of mucked around with a little, as all the hitters are, with just speed changes and a slower curveball, timing everything, and some days it just comes so naturally and it just, you're loving every second of it, and the other day it's as tough as.
You wish you never picked up the sport. You wish your dad never gave you a bat. You wish you'd be a cross-country runner or something. Or a fisherman. Fishing sucks sometimes too, though. Ooh, behind him. Went after his Achilles tendon there.
Yeah, got one round the back of him, and it did flick it on the way through, as you saw with Denning bolting out of the box. So he'll move to first base. HPB, a little wild one from Godbolt. So we first and second and one out. Maddox.
Probably some bullpen action as well.
Yep, Matt Wilson.
The young lefty warming up. Got a pretty smooth delivery down there. Looks like he will be competitive. Good slider guy. And I think he will be entering this game quite soon, especially the way Got Bold is up to about 5 walks now in 2 1/3.
Yep, and hit pitch ball.
That's not a good number. Any way you put it. Got to have action in the bullpen.
So Wilson was the late inclusion for Sayers in the game one and had to hit in the four hole, and that didn't work for him at all. So he came out of that game at some stage, but that wasn't necessarily the ace's fault. That was just unfortunate. And he had a little spin in game two out of the pen and had another spin in game three out of the pen. So getting their bang for buck out of Matthew Wilson. So a decisive little moment here for Godbold, just to maybe get himself an extra little bit of time in the middle as he gets one middle in. Maddox rips it foul down the first baseline. Youngster
from South Australia as well, Matt Wilson.
Is he?
That's what it says. Bedford Park. Maybe grew up in Victoria though. You'd know him.
Okay, well,
maybe if he played club ball here in South Australia, wouldn't you, Spurlo?
Well, I would have thought so, and I'm sort of now, you know, it is ringing a little bit of a bell, but only a light frame, but got a nice live arm. Godbold, and again Maddox just such a fine art angle out at centre left field, takes the catch, but that's a sack fly. So a good job there by Craig Maddox, got the job done. Didn't exactly get it the way he would have liked, but lifted one out to the outfield and job done. And that run puts the Bite ahead, 4-3. This is the sort of time that Lodgie normally does something. Just pops out when you least expect it. And whiff through that slider outside, strike one. Needed a...
Cheating there. He was going up saying he's going to lay that fastball right over the middle of the plate, first pitch, and I'm going to put it in left center, but... Godbold had different plans and threw the outside slider. Sometimes that happens with a runner in scoring position, a base empty. You don't have to be too particular with your pitches. You don't have to give in to the hitter is what I meant to say. You don't have to absolutely go after him. You can kind of, you know, nibble a little bit because that base is open. Not that he wants to rack up another walk, but he's definitely not going to miss over the middle of the plate as a plan. Well, sometimes with bases loaded or without that base open, you're not going to want to walk another guy or advance a base runner. So you kind of give in sometimes and throw that pitch, catch a little bit more plate. is one of those opportunities as a hitter where you got that RBI out there, but you also got to be patient and wait for your pitch.
And a good example there by Deglin, that tough little pop fly, and he gets one off the handle, flies it to left field. Josh Hendricks out there and takes a catch, but Deglin got a tough one over his head and he absolutely got on his bike and flew for it. So effort level with him, not to be questioned. We'll be back in a moment.
The Bites take on some runs, and now it is a 4-3 ball game as we head along to the top of the fourth. Your Adelaide Bite would like to extend a quick thank you to all of our members who participated in the members.
At Hog's Breath, there's something we take very seriously. Delicious, tender steak, just how you like it. Slow cooked for 18 hours, the traditional prime rib steak is still king. Seriously great steak for serious steak lovers.
Ground ball back at the pitcher. Tola recovers and Canberra are the champions of Australian baseball.
The month of February is fast approaching, and so too is the Australian Baseball League Championship Series. Who will claim the shield in 2015? Find out live on ESPN and MLB Network.
Barber makes the call, it's all over, and the Perth Heat have done it.
Now batting, designated hitter number 7, Scott Wern.
So Scott Wern lead the top of the fourth off in a tight little contest. 4-3 scoreline, Bites wait. Coombs comes in and misses. So I'm sure there'd be, even though there's no action at the moment, I thought Morgie might be on a little bit of a, just a, not so much of a shortened day, but Wern lifts one and tries to get it over the top of Chan Jong Moon, but again, he's a 6-foot rangy type and got some lovely athleticism, and he leapt and got a hold of it.
Quite graceful there. Good to see.
Thought maybe this might be it for Morgan, and Tolles might be due for a good little spit out to throw a good 2 or 3, and Mathis could throw 1 or 2, depending on how far Tolles goes, and give Brunneman a crack too, but maybe they'll just let Morgan ride it through.
Morgan wants that win too as well. He's right at 2 behind Tolles. He may want, for personal reasons, that league lead in wins, that record number of ABL season wins, and he's right there knocking on the door. He's got a lead here. I doubt if any of those runs he's given up are earned either. So we'll see. I'm sure he wants that victory, and he's got 2 more starts at least, and he also gets some bullpen work in, so he may sneak into that 9 win range.
Can't let the vulture in.
Tolles, yeah,
he got a canny,
as well.
Uncanny knack.
He's been great, though. And the ERA is still down there low. It's not like he's given up big leads or anything. He comes in pressure-packed situations and doesn't get the loss, at least. You know, it's a win. Oh, nice pause by Coombs there. It's hard to hit that when he does that with his motion. You know, you're trying to get in a rhythm, watching him on deck and watching him from the dugout and try to gather some timing. And then he pulls that out of the bag and just pauses for about 3 seconds at the top of his delivery.
Exactly, and he does it again. It's just all about timing for a hitter, just trying to get that front foot down to really let that back hip start that swing and fire through. And there he is, just pausing and, hang on, I thought you were pitching just about now, and what are you doing to me?
and then he'll do a quick one sometimes as well. It's fun to watch as a fan, not as a hitter. And he just comes with a really slow one there. When you've had as much success as Coombs has had this year, you can start to mess with stuff even a little bit more and experiment and pull some new tricks out of the bag. And no one can argue with a 2-3 ERA that he has and a 7-1 win-to-loss record. So,
absolutely, and he started off, with his ERA was about 7 after his first appearance or two, and then he just slowly really just found it. And that ball hit hard by George Fowle down the third baseline. And since then, he just has not looked back, and he's peeled his ERA back to about 2.2 or something like that. Got his wins. Durable. Acting as a little setup guy too when the time is right in the early games of a series. And good swing by George. Just got that slider again. Sat and waited and snicked it into the face mask of Thorpe. Foul ball. Full count. One out. Coombs comes again. That little backdoor slider, but George is having nothing of it. Not going to let it go by. Fouled another one off. So a good AB by Darryl George.
I've had the pleasure of playing against this guy, Darryl George, in a couple years that I played in the ABL, and he, from what I see this year, it's been a lot of improvement. And he's just getting that more experience in the States, played in the Midwest League this past year in Bowling Green, and just getting the work in. Got another 250 at-bats under his belt this year in the States, and it shows. He is hitting about 320 with a small sample size, but it just seems a more competitive at-bat as opposed to the past when I remember seeing him.
Poor, when he's monstered that one.
That's it.
And that's gone foul.
Yeah, so he has improved a lot, and he's putting in his work, and he looks a bit more fitter this year as well. He used to be a bit chunky from what I remember, if it's the same Darryl George. And he's getting in good shape, playing a lot of baseball, and it's showing. And he's one or two good years away from being a solid player, possible big league player if he just sticks around a few more years in those minor leagues and grinds it out.
Coombs, as he has done so often, he doesn't let things phase him, and it's just all about location. And again, he rolls a slider inside and got a little, maybe induced a little foul tip from George, but received by Thorpe, so struck out. Two out. Again, he just rolls one inside, but misses a little up. Ball one. Angle, who's been patrolling center field and, like Denning, a very good outfielder, and he again gets a little sinking fastball that he had to just drop down with the knees a little to get on its line, and took a good hack at it and fouled it straight over the back. So he, right around the mark. He's always looked around the mark. He's been good too. Just consistent. Not going to go home with any massive report card from this weekend, but solid, competitive.
Athletic.
Coombs comes inside and gets the front corner just. I think they might be $30 a game, $30 a ticket next week, crew, if you're asking questions on the chat line there, that prices will go up, but we've got to pay for ESPN and potentially pay for Jamie's employment for the weekend, so they're going to bump those ticket prices up. So we'll be back in a flash.
We'll be right back.
Aussie Ripper Roast, Builders Fencing and Roofing, Yarkabar Hotel, Optimum Home Solutions, Dutch Air Energy Smart, GB Electrical and Solar, Supps and More, Coopers, Golden Nor, First Time Driving, North Adelaide Dental Care, Lion and Dairy Drinks Australia, Corns Toyota, DMC Australia, M&C Fruit and Freshwater Systems. Thank you all for your continued support this season, and folks, how about a round of applause for the sponsors that make this all possible. And ladies and gentlemen, we have a pitching change for the Melbourne Aces leaving the ballgame. Number 43, Hayden Godbold. He is replaced on the mound by number 1, Matt Wilson. And of course, we have another birthday announcement. Shauna Lodge. Happy birthday to Shauna Lodge, Ben Lodge's mother. Off here in the bottom of the fourth inning for the Adelaide Bites, left fielder number 15, Tony Bocca.
Come on, come on, come on.
So Tony Bocca with the blast over centre right at his previous at bat, a 2-run shot. Takes one inside, ball one. So Wilson replaces Godbold on the mound. Sorry, Jamie, cut in on you.
He's the former Orioles farmhand, this Matt Wilson guy. Got a little bit of time in the Gulf Coast League in 2013, but now he's looking to be pitching mainly in Australia, it's going to look like. Bocca gets another hit there. Good to see him. He's having quite a day. Making a push for that playoff spot, which it looks like he's earning it today.
Absolutely, and again, for all the... all the kids, you swing the bat hard, and although Tony would have got 30% contact with a hard swing, good enough to just get it over the top of third base and base hit.
Swing hard in case you hit it. One of the best coaching advices I've ever had. There's always a chance you can hit it.
Thought bunts, but he gets a hard one straight back to Wilson, and they try to turn a double play. Good job there by Deglan. Got Harmon was, as he had to receive, was sort of had flat feet and just had to use his core to get rid of that ball and throw it in the dirt to Deglan, who tried hard to pick it. Wilson that missed, and so Thorpe didn't get the job done. Brooke flowing through his sequence of signals again as Lyon comes to the plate.
I like this matchup for Corey here. Shouldn't be too much of a mystery with the lefty out there. Doesn't seem to hide the ball too well. Not too overpowering as well. Corey should let loose on one here. Now he's going to have a guy in scoring position as well. Nice attempt on the block by Numana, but there's only so much you can do when those balls hit the ground. You never know really where they're going to bounce.
That's right, and Wilson intimated and tapped his chest a couple of times to Numana and said, my bad, sorry about that, threw it about 59.8 feet. Made it pretty tough going for Numana.
Corey finds himself in a 2-0 count here. Runner in scoring position. Gotta like this situation as a hitter.
Misses outside.
This is one of those situations he's only looking to drive in that run here. It doesn't matter about moving the runner over. With one out, he's looking to put one in a gap here. The only time you worry about moving him over is with no outs. I hate that one as a hitter when I hit a ground ball to second base with a man on second. and one out, and the dugout tries to give me high fives and say, "Way to move him over." You know, you don't, you're trying to score him there. You're not trying to move him over with no outs. You're trying to move him over and have him in a spot where he can score on a sack fly or an easy infield grounder. But with one, if you do it with one out, then there's going to be two outs after you ground out. You're not really doing that much good, because that ground ball for the next hitter or the fly ball for the next hitter isn't a sack fly anymore. It's the third out of the inning. So it's your job to score him here. One out, runner in scoring position.
And he's doing his best. A couple of solid swings, foul balls.
Yep, not giving up. Trying to find that barrel here. Doesn't look too fooled with the swings either.
And he gets. Lines one straight away to Cousins at right field. So unfortunate for Corey there. He put a good swing on and got plenty on it. Drove it hard right field, but big fella hardly had to move. He nearly removed the cap and taking a classic catch.
Very unfortunately for Corey there, he did find some barrel, but he also found a glove in right field. That's baseball sometimes. He should know, though, that the right fielder usually plays there, and he's been playing there for a couple hundred years, so got to find a different spot to hit that ball. Just bad aim, we'd say. That sarcastic baseball dugout talk. I'm not giving Corey any grief there. Just a little sarcasm.
So Moon swings around to the right side with the lefty on the mound. And Wilson paints some black outside. One and one, two out. Bottom four, bite by one. 4-3 ball game. Runner in scoring, so RBI chance here for Moon, and he Wilson puts one in the dirt, and again Namada with good technique, just straight to the knees and pats it down.
Didn't really seem to have figured out his right-handed swing yet. He's only hitting 130 against left-handed pitchers this year, and that's when he's batting right-handed. But, again, small sample size.
A 2-2.
Only 23 at-bats, so it's tough to get in a groove with that right-handed swing sometimes when you're facing mostly righties and using the left-handed swings. But looks
like he's hit one in the hole. Only Brad Harmon could possibly make a play like that. What a sensational attempt by Harmon. Just in the 5-6 hole and a backhand play and just no hesitation. Whipped it around to Davies. He tried to get a little tag, but a good slide there. Excellent slide there by Will Thorpe.
Just pretty late slide as well. He probably didn't know where that ball was coming from. Brooke told him to get down just at the last minute. Looked like the throw kind of beat him. He should have just got to stuff that tag in his face a little bit more next time. By the third baseman there, Davies. One of those tough plays, though. A lot of moving parts running all around there. The guy's bearing down on you from second base to third base. The shortstop's running, making a throw on the run. The ball's got movement on it. You kind of ran for that ball because it was in the 5-6 hole as well. Then you got to charge back to third base, and he was there. Just bad luck. Great play by Harmon, though. We've seen him be really athletic. On that one first and third player in the first inning, that was really cool to see. I wish we had a better replay of it, but he caught that ball from the catcher and then was falling down and got rid of the ball as fast as he could and was able to throw Corey Lyon out by a couple steps at home plate trying to steal home in that first and third situation. He is one athletic guy. And now it seems like the Melbourne Aces just picked over about three or four times in a row with Moon there. They know he is a running threat.
Yes, Harmon. One of the best shortstops ever produced by this country. Showing all of his talent and prowess. Such a tough posse, as we discussed before. Reason of the best two fielders, or your best fielders being up the middle, because that's where the majority of the balls go. So you've got a lot of responsibilities, and of course you're the cut-off men for all plays to all bases. It's a tough position, and only for the very, very best.
Yeah, the good ones got to be so athletic and so cool under pressure. It's not definitely one of the hardest positions, catcher and shortstop, like I said earlier.
Well, especially when you consider too, Jamie, you know, they field it, you know, just a tick under 1,000. You know, they're 995, 990 fielders. They barely make a mistake. And when you consider
the workload they have, yeah,
you know, to barely make a, you know, a glove error on all sorts of balls that you got to contend with.
It's amazing some of the guys that do it. Humans are awesome, what we're capable of, because it is not easy to do. That long throw and those crazy hops and spin on the balls.
Moon's off, and he steals second. So another stolen base to Chan Jong Moon.
They just don't throttle back. There's no quitting this Adelaide Bite team. You better show up ready to play when you come and play them, because they don't take a step back for anybody. They don't soften up and put the gloves on. They take the gloves off, and they're swinging hard the whole game, all nine innings. And they don't apologize for it. It's fun to watch, though. That's a good product they're putting out there. Some people may say they should let up every once in a while, but, yeah, you're playing four games a week, and they're just going to go full speed the whole time and then shoot first, ask questions later. And we've enjoyed watching them this year, huh? It's been fun.
Well, that's why we scored a lot of runs, and that ball's flowing left field. Hendricks wobbling his way back, but he takes the catch. So retires the Bite as we complete four. And the Adelaide Bite got a one-run lead in a 4-3 ball game. See you in a momento.
Matthew just swats it off. Congratulations, guys. There's the sibling love. That was the Use Your Noodle Challenge brought to you by My Money House. Everything that kills me makes me feel alive. I've been losing sleep. Dreaming about the things that we could be. Baby, I've been praying hard. Say no more counting dollars. We'll be counting stars.
Leading off here in the top of the fifth inning for the Melbourne Aces, the catcher number 16, Chase Umata.
Correction will. Yes, the old Devo. Get those flower pots on those heads and rock on. So Morgan Combs. Namada waits for that breaker, and Chan Jong sits down on it, and good job by Maddox. Wasn't a wild throw. And again, Moon just intimates to him, sorry about that, because he's different arm slot required over at second base. little bit more over the top at shortstop with longer throws. At second, you tend to drop that arm down a little bit and have a lot more flexibility in it. And he just threw one over the top, drew Maddox off the base, but he came off, took it, and made a tag. Second option. Combs falls off the mound a little bit there and leaves that one up. Great to see Brad in the lineup. Not exactly sure why he hasn't been in it too much. Again, you're here to watch the very best, and what a pleasure it is to see this guy play shortstop and with a double to left field and crunched another one through line for an error which perhaps could have been put down as another base hit. He's having a pretty good night. Pretty good afternoon, sorry. Where are we? What day is it, Jimbo? And he comes inside and he misses there. So four straight pitches and Harmon picks a walk. Deglan with a base hit at his last at-bat. Really hasn't got one the way he'd like to get one, and I'm sure he keeps looking over at that fence and thinking, come on, surely I can get one over it. It's 16 long balls, every state in Australia, and here he is in Adelaide, and I'm sure would like to, well, I want to see one. I'm sure Jamie does too. He likes to see,
I love the long
good
ball.
Athletes.
I want to see him put a charge in one. Sorry, Coombs. But I love watching Coombs pitch as well. But, yeah, I want to see this guy hit a bomb. Of course, everybody shows up to the park to watch the long ball.
Oof, cold strike. And Kellen looks right around and says, wow, you've got to be kidding me. That did look a little up. So with Harmon on first, and Deglan calls time, granted. So we reset. Said last night, he got a major league swing, this guy. And just when he really cuts the ribbons and lets one go, and he flies that one. Centre field, Denning, beautifully positioned, hit it straight to him, but still another nice swing of the bat. So 16 home runs, 35 RBIs for Deglan.
That's a good line, no matter where you're playing, the amount of games he's played. About 30-something games, or 40 now. They're up to, what's the how many games have they played thus far?
About 42 or
yeah,
something,
42.
Maybe.
That's a good line. It's a home run every 10 at-bats, every in between 10 and 15 at-bats. Good ratio there.
That was a good swing by Davies there, so the breaking pitch by Coombs, and he says, I'll take 10K off of that same pitch and see how this one goes. And again, you saw Davies' eyes spinning.
Not having the easiest day so far.
So he's hadn't been too many hitters. I think we saw on Genny with a really strange little pitch there. He hardly lifted his front foot and just hoik this little thing over, which barely made the distance. He's a funky old unit, old Morgan Coombs.
Yep, as funky as he is, that's part of his competitive nature. You know, he's not going to stick to any mold. He's going to do what it takes to get the outs, and he gets Davies there on the punch out. Like I said, Davies can rack those punchies up.
And he's doing a good job today, 2 out of 3, so we'll see you back here in a moment.
SA Power Networks employs more than 2,000 South Australians and delivers electricity to around 840,000 customers. We don't make electricity, and we don't sell it either. What we do is deliver electricity to your home. From the Rundle Lantern to our airport, hospitals, schools, and traffic lights, power is vital to the function of our state. That's why our team is on call 24/7, rain, hail or shine, to respond to any emergency. Plus, we're taking the initiative to ensure that everyone can access information about their power supply however and wherever they like. We also foster vital connections through more than a dozen community sponsorships. At SA Power Networks, we're working with you to deliver the power you need, now and in the future. Think less but see it grow. Like a ride, oh. Not easily offended, not hard to let it go. From a mess to the masses.
So Tommy Bryce, with our flick that comes up of him, is with his stats, etc. If that doesn't make you laugh, you're very hard to please. He chops one second base, and George wears one in the belly, but had a nice soft mitt and took it.
He's looking like he's got a good pair of hands out there in the middle infield. Turned into a middle infielder. When I was playing against him a couple years ago, he was DHing a lot and playing third base and wasn't up to snuff just yet, and now he seems to turn himself into a good ball player, impact player. He can really help out a side. Melbourne's got to be happy about that. And the Rangers.
Denning, first pitch flies out to Hendricks, and again, he didn't really get the most wonderful read on things, but got the job done. Took an overhead catch out there. So Maddox and Wilson with a very economical little deal at the moment, doing a good job. A couple of pitches in this dig for one count.
It's young versus the old here, the 29-year-old Maddox versus about the 20-year-old Matthew Wilson. Both have had time in the affiliated ball in the States playing for.
And some defensive changes for your Adelaide Bites. Leading the ball game is number 17, Mitch Denning. He's placed in center field by number 18, Simon Walk. Take it in, but don't look down. And a pitching change for the Adelaide Bites. Leaving the ball game. It's number 28, Morgan Combs. He's placed on the mound by number 12, Colin Feltman.
Me and you. What's the difference between between me and you. Me and you. Me and you.
Back when Q was rolling with Lorenzo in a Benzo, I was banging with a gang of instrumentals. Got the pens and pencils, got down to business. But sometimes the business ended it can turn your friends against you. But you was a real, I could sense it in you. I still remember the window of the car that you went through. That's it. But I'll never forget what we've been through.
Leading off here in the top of the sixth inning for the Melbourne Aces, right fielder number 18, Dylan Cousins.
So Cousins. Interesting pronunciations of names that Coombs with the double O MBS, but supposedly it Combs and COZENS, like Cousins, or perhaps pronounced Cousins, but
that soft S there, Cousins, instead of Cousins, you're saying?
Yeah, well, I'm not sure I'm calling him Cousins, but
I'm going to call him Cousins too. Or we just call him Cuz.
Dylan Wallace Cousins.
But also we got some changes here as well. Feltman's now into pitch. And there's a center fielder making his debut for the Adelaide Bites.
He did have a bat. He did have an at-bat in the previous game, but
debut in front of me.
Correct.
James McCohen debut.
In front of the very eyes of Jay McCohen. Playing center field, replacing Mitch Denning. Simon Walk. And there's Cousins. Pops that one straight over that would have landed on our heads just about.
And you see with this game after the clinch, and there's not much to play for besides momentum and fine-tuning for the Bite. They are going to let some of the younger guys get a chance and get a crack. I'm sure Brooke wants to see him play, and guys don't want to come out here too much and not get any playing time, which it's not about that. It's about wins and losses at this level, but now you have a chance to put the guys in there when the wins and losses don't mean as much anymore. They actually mean nothing for the Bite, you know. They're going to have that home grand final, get the chance at three games here, and be ABL premieres. And you can let some of the guys get a taste, as they'd say.
Chops that onto his foot. Foul ball.
Kensington has been pretty impressed with this walk guy, and they're pushing for him to get out here with a Bite, and Brooks giving him a go. Good to see. Can't wait to see him get another at bat.
Gee, when you're just picturing him standing alongside this big unit in the box at the moment, and again, Cuz takes a walk. Be like chalk and cheese, he'd come up to his hip, I reckon.
He could just about eat him.
Put him in a hot dog roll and with some ketchup.
Not what you want to see from Feltman there either, walking the leadoff guy. Especially with the 12.7 ERA that he's got. You don't want to be putting any guys on base. He hasn't been fooling too many people this year with the Bite. And I think he is a guy that's played for Brooke in the past, though, and Brooke trusts him and likes him and is letting him work through a rough patch here with this season with the Bite. See if he's going to be one of those arms he puts on the playoff roster.
And again, you could just see it again. He wants to go, and Thorpe's Chan Jong just
got jammed there on that tag. Kind of ball came across right at the same time as the slide was going across. And Moon had to have his glove there. And with the 250, 270 pound, 120 kilo guy and Cousins, there's going to be room for injury there and an opportunity if someone can get hurt. A lot of fast moving parts, as I've said before. The ball coming in there quick, the speedy runner, and Moon trying to get in there as well at the same time and have a glove there. Looks like he might have jammed a wrist, bruised a forearm, maybe dislocated a finger or something. Doesn't look too beat up, but he is definitely not in a comfortable situation now. Not what Brooke Knight would want to see going down with that playoff push with one of his leading stolen base getters in Chan Young Moon. Looks to be okay, though.
Yeah, he does. I think he might have just, the elbow just sort of on the, got a little rickshaw as the big fella went through as he was trying to take the ball, and might have just just hyperflex that elbow just a fraction. And especially when you're sort of today and they've flipped things around and let Corey play shortstop and throw Chan Jong over to second base. Last thing they'd want is a little injury, just be very inopportune. But he's reset, ready to roll. Tough dog. So Josh Hendricks in the box. It's Feldman.
Heads up over there on the hill.
And again, with no disrespect whatsoever to Colin.
That is yours to keep next to SA Power Network.
If this doesn't wake a few of the Aces hitters up and think, you know, I much prefer this sort of stuff to trying to hit that funky little slider in three different arm slots at six different speeds with five different release points. Give me a guy that brings it on a little bit, and here he is.
And like I was saying earlier too, sharks smell that blood in the water, and they see the guy 7-1, Coombs with a 2-something ERA. You're thinking, oh gosh, this guy again. And then when you see the guy with the 12-7 ERA, you start to lick your chops a little bit and say, oh, this guy may be a bit friendlier. Friendlier guy to take a nice big hack against and feel comfortable in there. It's got to be something different between him and Coombs, obviously, with the numbers don't lie that much. And there is something a bit easier with Feldman, possibly.
And there's Moon again with a little basket catch. Little Willie Mays. But again, that tough little ball that in between a... And Lodgie normally all over those, and not that he wasn't, because he probably could have sprawled forward and potentially taken it, but Moon straight on his bike, fully committed. Get back, got a nasty little one where he just had to really flash the leather and hope it pops in, and of course it pops in. Funny when your commitment's strong and your confidence is high, how many of those you take in comparison when you're doing it a little bit tough.
I love seeing that, the infielders being able to go back and get a ball. That just means the outfielders can play that much deeper and prevent those big extra base hits and cut those balls off in the gap and keep those singles kept to singles and not turn into hustle doubles or stuff. So you can put that right fielder a little bit deeper now and rob a home run or stop that trouble from happening, because the infielders can take care of the bloopers for you. I think it's important for infielders to practice fly balls, because a lot of damage is done in between the infielder and the outfielder on those bloopers. With those two out RBI singles you see that just take the wind out of a team's sails or a pitcher's sails and really hurt. And to be able to have an athletic guy like Moon go back and get him really helps.
Feldman puts that in the dirt. Thorpe supports. So Colin had a little spit right at the end last night. He didn't finish the game. He set for Bruneman. Did a good job, had a little moment, but ended up getting through. And again, it's just such a bonus when you've got a team that plays solid D behind you and can make extraordinary plays, make something out of nothing. Even that one that might think that, you know, don't carry on, but it was a tough one. And I'd say on the flip side that, you know, it would have landed for a lot of teams, but huge commitment. And Moon did it last night from shortstop, got a similar ball going to left field that was potentially going to die and hit the ground, and he charged back on it, never took his eyes off the ball. Made the catch. And all the in-betweeners and the little things, and it just extends a pitcher, gives them confidence. And all those little things keep adding up to keep you with live arms in your bullpen instead of being reaching, and a little bit like the Aces having to go to position players to just sort of complete games. But with Tolles and Mathis. And you can thank the field for that. There's a ball. Darryl George picks up a base hit and looks at his men on the way through and pretty happy. He scores Cozens. So Aces get on the board and tie this one up 4 apiece.
And that'll tie the game at
Good piece of hitting there by George. Didn't try to do too much with it. Not to sound cliche, but just stayed back and drove it just enough the other way. And not too hard. Find that little hole in between second base and right field. I'd give that a solid line drive, though. Pretty good piece of hitting. It's definitely hitting over 300, one of the higher averages on the Melbourne Aces team. Somewhat leading the charge for him in a way, which is good to see after a successful year in the States in Bowling Green for the Tampa Bay Rays organization. And he's looking, thinking of stealing as well. And I like this, even though it's a hangover game, kind of the bite of clinch, the teams are stealing bases, playing hard baseball, working on stuff, trying to get good reads, trying to do first to thirds, trying to steal bases. Yeah, exciting baseball. Never a day off here at Norwood Oval with these with the bite plan.
George is off, and there's a pitch out and a great throw. And although that maybe if you really had a great time to have a replay and have a look and whatever, he may have avoided that tag, but bottom line is ball beat the runner and a beautiful throw right at the base of the at the
good
the
pitch
base
ball too. The pitch out,
yeah, good stuff. Well read again by the Adelaide Bite. We'll be back. Four all ball game. Still a bit of interest and lots to play for. We'll see you back here in a moment.
Fast approaching, and so too is the Australian Baseball League Championship Series. Who will claim the shield in 2015? Find out live on ESPN and MLB Network.
Barber makes the call, it's all over, and the Perth Heat have done it.
Leading off here in the bottom of the sixth inning for the Adelaide Bite, proudly supported by SA Power Networks, number 15, left fielder, Tony Vodka.
We're bringing it back here to the bottom of the sixth inning with the Bite in a deadlock with the Melbourne Aces, tied at 4-4 here. Tony Vodka leading it off, already with a home run and a single today. Facing the tough lefty, Matthew Wilson.
So Wilson rolls on. Vodka.
Finds himself in a hitter's count here. Tie ball game. Should be looking to do some damage. Looking for extra bases here. Can't be late on a fastball here. Got to drive it to the middle.
Oh, good hack. Well read. And good hack by Vodka. Followed the script. Was a little up, but he still put a good swing on and was about an inch away. Comes again and misses downstairs. So good lead off by Vodka in a four all ball game in the two-thirds of the way through. Becomes a base runner. And be suggesting that Will might play a little bit of short ball here.
Four.
squares around to bunt and gets a job done. Superb bunt. Wilson having to do a little ole out of the back of the hand just in the position he was caught at, but good enough to get the job done. Excellent bunt by Thorpe. Pushes Vocca into scoring. One out. So now another good little spot here for Corey, just with the runner. We're talking on our way here, Jamie, and you think that hitting is just hitting, but hitting is different when runners are on, and regardless, it does have an effect. And Wilson strays with the pitch inside and hits line. So
yeah, it is different. The pitcher's going to throw you different with those guys in scoring position, especially, and with bases open, every situation changes things.
And even just tension, Jamie, you know, like, it is a different thing, and you shouldn't be thinking about it, but you know, it's obvious what's on stake here, and especially for a hitter, that RBI. That RBI tally is probably one of the proudest as a hitter. If you're a man that's known that you knock runs in, that's what you're called, a clutch hitter. And to be known as a clutch hitter is a pretty big rap.
Those guys stick around for a while. Get paid the big bucks.
That's what you've lived off, hey?
Oh, not very well. But I'm having a good time.
Yeah, give yourself a break. I mean,
We're trying. Some good years. I had some good years playing ball. Was able to drive in some runs here and there.
Yeah, no, exactly. And that's what we're sort of talking about here, is that you are a good hitter and still are. And still finding that you can go through periods, and just like anyone, whether you're starting out and feeling a bit iffy, and there you are, an experienced campaigner, and can still go through moments. So it doesn't get any different, doesn't matter how old or how experienced or how wise or what your reputation is. Every day's a different day, and
it's a challenge, and I love it. It's good, honest competition. That's one thing I loved about playing ball at that competitive level. It's you really got no one to blame but yourself at the end of the day. The guys you're facing can't backstab you or nothing. That pitcher's doing what his job is. There's no office BS, as they'd say, and backtalk in that sense. And cheating, really, you know, you can't really cheat that much with the umpires out there. It's just pretty honest, hard competition. That guy's trying to beat you with a ball, and you're trying to hit that ball with a round bat, and it doesn't get easier in any stages. Just good, honest competition. I love it. I did love it. Still do.
So Moon with a 2-1 count. Swinging, as we mentioned, switch hitter. So swinging from the right side, where his average is down a tad. And George keeping Vocca in check at second. He's with one out. Every inch counts out there. You let him get a big lead, and just on a single up the middle, he'll score. But hold his lead back, single up the middle, he may not score. And is a potential solo double play for the champion, Brad Harmon, and that's a walk in the park for him. So the Bite are thwarted in the bottom of the sixth. We've still got a 4-4 ball game. This is going to be interesting. We will see you soon.
All right, it's now, usually it's time for Get Gus, but this time it's Gus Gets the Kids. The kids are going to get a bit of a head start, and Gus is going to chase them down. Kids, are you ready? Get on out here. We got this quickly. So, kids, start running. Gus, go run with these kids and go get them. Go get them, Gus. Go get them. Go get them. Run, Gus. Run. Who will Gus get? Gus gets a couple of them. There he goes. He's running pretty fast. Go, Gus, go. Brought to you by North Adelaide Dental. Go, Gus.
folks, it's not just SA Power Networks. Power balls you have to watch out for in the stands. We've got some stress balls making their way up, courtesy of the Bite Dugout.
So top of the seventh. Four all. Started a little tardily, perhaps, if we can be a little bit harsh, but all of a sudden balanced out a little bit, and as we get to any money time of a game, the stakes lift, and you'll find now that all of a sudden you'd be seeing the levels rise a little bit, and it's going to be who can get it done here, who can do the right stuff at the right time. Tolles
is that guy that always seems to find himself in these pressure-packed situations when the game's on the line. And no different today. Brook puts him out there right in the big spots. Bat goes flying there. Needs a little bit more pine tar. No one hurt, though. Brook Knight gives it back to him after putting a curse on it, probably.
Timmy Russell, the smiling assassin, just grabs that bat, gives it back to Engel and says perhaps you could use it a bit more wisely than chuck it at us. So the pine tar is brought out. Sticky stuff it is.
Josh Tolles, 9-1 with a 2.32 ERA. 31 innings pitched and 40 strikeouts. That's an incredible line. You know, considering another bat just got thrown from the on-deck circle against the backstop. Not sure what's going on. I guess it's a hot, sweaty day.
Chase was just swinging up and lost control of the bat and hit the backstop. So it's all happening.
That's one thing that Tolles has a problem with is the control a little bit. He's got 20 walks in 31 innings, which is a bit high. You'd like to see him at about two or three walks per nine innings pitched, not four or five, what he's at now, or six or seven even. So always a work in progress. You never have baseball figured out. No matter how good the line is, there's always room for improvement. Tolles knows that. And this is going to be good to see, though. Fast runner on base, center fielder and Adam Engel. And Tolles, who can really hold runners on effectively. He goes up there and he reads. If you take off, he can pick over. Tough to steal on.
Yes, Namada asked to bump there and potentially got a pitch that he could have put into play, but fouled it. Gave himself a little punch on the cleat, a little disappointed with himself. Because this is sort of his, something that he had got to adapt himself to, push guys around and got to bunt the ball effectively. Especially when you're on the rise, you nearly just about have to do everything right. And if you're a smaller guy that got to punch the ball around a little bit, you've got to bunt effectively. It's not easy either. I mean, especially with breaking pitches to put the ball to the ground. That's what you've got to do. Put the ball to the ground at a reasonably soft sort of pace, just enough to elude the catcher. Just draw a little half circle at 10 metres up the lines. Just try to roll it into that little area.
Didn't like that call from Mark there. Thought the curveball was inside or a bit high, but didn't look too bad from our angle. No excuses. You know, you got to get that ball down. It was a buntable ball. And I'm sure Tommy Thompson is getting frustrated this time of year with the bad record that they have and just their inability to execute simple tasks. Getting that sack bunt down on the top of the seventh in a tie ball game with a good runner on first. But baseball is hard. No task is that simple, especially when you're facing a guy like Josh Tolles with the line he's got.
Absolutely. He's a, you know, maybe obviously different, but a left-handed Coombs in the way that he uses different arm slots, different speeds. Mm. He can rev it up and get it into the, you know, mid to high 80s. Ball blasted down the first baseline, but foul.
Yeah, he is Coombs-like in his ability to hold runners and change his times to the plate and use different arm slots. He'll come down to the side a little bit when he's facing the lefties and try to, you know, bend a slider around him or run a fastball in on him. And he can also hump up, as they say, and throw that high cheese and blow it by guys as well. Got the big slow curveball, got the fast curveball. Safe.
Oh.
He was moving there, Angle, though. Got picked off. Tolles did read it correctly. That's when Angle was just running on first move, and he was going like a bat out of hell at second base and slid so fast that he went right past the bag. They are sliding hard at second base, which is how the game's supposed to be played. You know, you got to go in there hard. Especially when you get picked off, it's kind of like, oh, shucks. Just got an unnecessary out for the team. But if you go hard, hustle, the baseball gods will reward you. And now he finds himself in scoring position with less than two out. Job done for Numata as far as moving the runner over.
Exactly. With a lefty, they often with a straight steal, it's just first move and then puts the pressure on that it's going to take two good throws to get you out. And the throws were pretty good. But as Jamie said, Engel really got on his bike and just committed to it.
Closed down on second base real quick. Looked like it was only a few steps away for him. And how about this situation, Tolson? He's in a situation where he can come up with his 10th win of the year. Those are records that are going to be tough to break come the future as well. You know, you got four starters. You play about 45, 50 games. You got about 10 starts apiece. And to come up with 10 wins, and he's not a starter. He's a reliever. He's really found himself in a, you know, this is a nonsensical situation coming across with 9 wins, and he's got a lot more opportunities to get 10 or 11 or 12 even with the way the Bite are playing and the amount he's used. He's in an easy situation for a win here if the Bite get a couple of runs. He's going to be the pitcher on record. And double-digit wins is right at his doorstep if he wants to take it. Amazing. Nothing's been close like that, has it? What, 7-8 wins is usually the top?
Yeah, you'd think so. I mean, weren't some of the...
Let alone a reliever doing it.
Mm. Yes, the vulture call has been used regularly with this guy. He uses it on himself. He's semi-embarrassed about it, to be honest. But, hey, he doesn't set the rules or create the games. He just plays.
And he does a great job at it. You know, there sure are, I'm sure, a few inherited runners he wish wouldn't have scored. But in the end, his runners aren't scoring. Guys aren't able to get from home plate back to home plate against him. And, you know, they're not losses he's given up. He's getting the wins for the team at the end of the day. And he does have a 2.3 ERA. He's not getting hit around that hard. And he's got his 40 strikeouts in 30 innings pitched, which is a great number, having 10 more strikeouts than any pitch. It's about 10, 11, 12 strikeouts per 9 innings. It's just a good line you can't argue with. No matter what he does the rest of the year, you got to figure he's going to get some Pitcher of the Year award or something.
And there's a great pitch. He just clipped the front corner. He just froze Numata, who probably had rights to be thinking that that was a 50-50 call. However, on a two-strike count, you know, you've got to be protecting. And it was location, absolute location. If it was anywhere, Pat's Bar there, you'd nearly suggest that Chase would have been swinging for sure. But it was just a beautifully executed third strike pitch, and there's another indication the quality of the young man. He hit spots. Again, he backed himself. He came in with the fastball.
You got to come in hard there in that situation, too. You don't want to put a pitch out over the plate outside corner and allow him to hit that soft ground ball to second base. You want to be able... And the batter's got to know that, too, because you're trying to go the other way, and the pitcher knows that, so he's going to try to do the opposite. He's going to try to go against your plan and throw hard in and beat you up with that inside fastball. And sometimes it's just good to take a chance there, especially with two strikes. You can't be too much of a team at bat. You just got to fight to get that runner, to just make contact. and not strike out there. And, you know, good things will happen if you make contact. Great stolen base there by Engel. He's taken over this inning with the base running, got into third base and put that winning run only 90 feet away. Maybe a situation where you kind of pitch around Harmon here as well. But got Engel on deck, which is no easy task. Deglin on deck.
You bet. It's the fielder playing in. So he's popped it. Foul ball. So it's game on here and nothing asked for, nothing being given that the Adelaide Biter brought the infield in to stop this run if they can. Narrows down the angles and
sudden gust of wind just came and blew one of the Commonwealth Bank marquees over in the Adelaide Bite dugout and set the smiling assassin Pete to the ground. A couple other guys are worried over there as well. Just one of those, what do they call them, little mini tornadoes that pop up here in Adelaide. What do they call those little vectors?
Whirly whirlies.
Oh, a whirly whirly.
Well.
A willy.
A willy willy.
A whirly willy. It's on Wikipedia.
Don't trust us.
A natural phenomenon that happens in Adelaide. That's what you see the catcher and pitcher looking over a few seconds ago for that. Everyone seems to be up and walking around and okay, though. Didn't seem to be that windy of a day either.
No, just there's that little tunnel, that little gap that comes through and has like a little bullet of wind and it just must have got up and under.
Yep.
As if there wouldn't be enough hot air being blown by the boys on the bench.
As expected, Harmon kind of got intentionally walked. Now there's the potential for the double play with Deglin hitting. Inning double play. And you kind of get around that dangerous Harmon with the impeccable reputation of the former big league star that he was. Not star, but he was up there. Everybody that makes it up there is a star, in my opinion. Well, yeah, double play in order. It'll be interesting to see if they run here, too, and maybe try to give Brooke a taste of his own medicine with a first and third thing, with a first and third steal of home.
Especially with the pivots changing up and just a little bit of difference and to execute first and third plays. Huge amount of coordination required. And again, just another practice drill over and over and over again.
Sometimes you see that attempted steal of home also with a lefty. As soon as he comes up, the guy from third starts to steal home, and then the guy at first base makes himself look like he needs to be picked off. And with Toll's reading,
it's trouble. Oh. So the Aces get one over. Engel scores on a combination of a lot of things. Some good base running. So great job there by Engel. Puts his team a run ahead.
Good hard base running there. Looks like Maddox just mishandled that ball, caught it off the heel. Tough little hop. And Deglin was hustling down and was able to beat the throw after the mix-up, after the boot by Maddox. But he does pull up a little bit lame. And
he might have pulled
and
jagged a hammy here. I just saw him run through the base, and he went straight for his thigh.
Good to see him still pulling hard, though, and not giving up on that play. Sometimes as a lefty, you see that chop ground ball, the one thing you didn't want to hit. And you don't hustle that much to first base and just expect to be out, but he was going hard the whole way.
You know, it's just one of those instantaneous with Tolles arriving at the same time. It just gave him a bit of a different look at the base, and he needed to just somehow alter his stride in flight. And he is a little ginger, and it looks like Dale will come in and replace him. So it hadn't been a great time here for Deglin. He's certainly not going to leave Adelaide with massively fond memories, which is a shame in some respects. Obviously, if you're a real hard man, you'd be really happy to keep a good athlete down. But hey, I think it's really enjoyable to see guys come here and enjoy the experience and have a bit of fun along the way. But he's going to be nursing a little muscle strain and a little cut lip. So it's been a tough old weekend, but he puts bat on ball, scores a run, puts his team ahead. So he continues to tough it out.
See if Davies can add to that lead here. I've been kind of beating him up a little bit today from the press box. But he can do a lot of redemption right here with a base hit, something in the gap against the always tough Tolles.
He picks on Maddox and they go for a double play.
Ballsy throw there by Maddox instead of just taking the easy out at first. It was a really close play there at second. Good job by Corey to corral it. It's a tough angle sometimes. He's basically throwing almost right behind the runner. That runner's bearing down on you and sliding. It's always a closer play than going from home to first as you got that 10-foot, 3-meter lead at least, and you're running on contact. You don't have to worry about dropping the bat or getting out of your swing. But I like that, aggressive play. Keep another run out of scoring position and get the out. Some teams, though, with a game like this, sometimes you just want to get that out and get out of the inning as quick as possible, take the sure out. But it ends up being a sure out.
And there's a great example there where Tolles just threw one at the shoulder of Cozens and he immediately withdrew from the box and it spun its way over the plate. This is a dangerous moment because he's a slugger and he's a very, he's a good hitter. He knows his zone. Not too much different to a guy like Bryce, Tommy Bryce, who really makes you throw strikes. This guy knows his strike zone well. He doesn't swing at poor pitches. Makes you throw strikes and he'll take whatever result is deserved.
Not afraid to mix in a strikeout as well. Got 38 strikeouts on the year in 40 games, so he's due. So that punch out there, he gets ahead with two strikes, so he gets the count back to even.
There's a great example again of a guy with slow slider, and then probably had Cozens thinking that another one was on the way, and he gets a fastball that he probably could crush, but he just was on his heels a little bit and was a bit slow. And then he wastes one outside, so.
Gonna go after him here. 3-2, this is the lefty he wants to face, I bet. Doesn't want to put another run in scoring position. Could be power against power here.
So two out, it's a big pitch. And there's the breaking pitch again. And yes, just had to be. As much as Cozens might have looked and not been happy again, that was just a beautifully executed pitch. Just busted across the plate and struck Cozens out and thwarted another potential bigger inning. But a one-run lead to the Aces as we go to stretch time. We'll see you in a moment.
And so too is the Australian Baseball League Championship Series. Who will claim the shield in 2015? Find out live on ESPN and MLB Network.
Barber makes the call, it's all over. And the Perth Heat have done it.
For the Melbourne Aces. Leading the ball game is number one, Matt Wilson. He's replaced on the mound by number four, Cody Buechel. Staying in the game at third base, number 37, Ryan Dale. Moving from third base to first, number 12, Josh Davies.
The time never seemed so good.
things off here in the bottom of the seventh inning for the Adelaide Pies. Third baseman number 22, Stefan Welsh.
Cody Buckle, or Buckle as he was introduced, replaces Matthew Wilson.
Yeah, Texas Rangers second round pick, got a live arm, but he has put up astronomical walk numbers in his minor league career so far. I mean, numbers that I can't even believe are real. Nine innings pitched in Double A 2013 and 28 base on balls. This past year, 56 innings pitched and 59 base on balls. How long do you let this guy run out there?
Well, you can see it, what, 22 years old that he is. He's out here to work on that one.
Obviously, yeah, that's why they sent him out here to work on it. Could be one of those last chance sort of things. Figure it out down under or don't even bother coming back. But you can tell he's got a live arm, a hammer of a curveball, and he's got to be able to run that fastball into the mid-90s, 95, 96 miles an hour, but just no idea where it's going. That's got to be a record of some sorts. Nine innings pitched, 28 base on balls. How do you let that go that long? Five game starts. But we'll see. See what Tom Bryce can do about it. And you were talking about favorite baseball players on the Adelaide Bite, and I'd have to say Tom Bryce is mine. Talking to him earlier about the players he likes, too, or the people he models his game after, and he was telling me how he really tries to model his baseball game after Ned Kelly. Guys like that, not necessarily baseball players, but just the attitude and mentality of those hard guys from back in the day. Some of his favorite guys to model his game after.
Oh, Jamie. Ned Kelly.
That's from Tom's mouth, not mine.
Oh, come on, you've made that up.
No.
Tom's a bizarre man.
I don't make that up.
That sounds outrageous. They're going to bunt. And he got a beautiful bunt down. He just cruises along the line, and so he gets the job done. Asked to bunt, executes beautifully, and Welshy strolls to two, gets in scoring, chasing a run here to tie things up in the seventh.
Young guy can do against this live arm. I guarantee you, Ward doesn't see many arms like this in the SABL. But he has been proving his worth there in the SABL and earning a chance here to play in the ABL.
Threw two good strikes there, Bickle. Threw one to induce a little chopper at the feet of Ward, and two to go and grab it and then get one to first base and throw a good strike too. So a couple of one to threes. Who says fielding off your own pitching isn't important? He's having to do it himself. But with Welsh on third and Maddox. Again, a big moment for Craig. Just as we said, it might be a little bit of a, at the end of the day, a ho-hum sort of game result-wise, but for Craig Maddox, oh, and that was a good swing. That was one of the better swings that he has laid for a while.
Pitcher two kind of reminds me of that all-out kind of Tim Lincecum pitching style. The guy that's not huge. He's not 190 centimeters tall. He's not the broadest shoulders in the world. He's not the 100 kilos like a Roger Clemens and those guys, but he's got those good ligaments, as they say, and can really find a way to generate power from a normal size package, which is impressive to see and fun to watch when the things are working for him.
Gets a chopper up the middle. He deflects it with a hand. Harmon comes in behind and collects, and Davies. So a mixture of about three or four different things then, but show the agility and skill of baseball players A little flick off the hand of Buechel, and Harmon just charging around behind second base. Beautiful gather and got rid of it, and needed Davies with all his stretch at first base to get out there and give him a hand, and he sure did. So some excellent D by the Aces, retain that one run lead. We'll be back top eight in a moment.
SA Power Networks employs more than 2,000 South Australians and delivers electricity to around 840,000 customers. We don't make electricity, and we don't sell it either. What we do is deliver electricity to your home. From the Rundle Lantern to our airport, hospitals, schools and traffic lights, power is vital to the function of our state. That's why our team is on call 24/7, rain, hail or shine, to respond to any emergency. Plus, we're taking the initiative to ensure that everyone can access information about their power supply however and wherever they like. We also foster vital connections through more than a dozen community sponsorships. At SA Power Networks, we're working with you to deliver the power you need, now and in the future.
Josh Hendricks will lead the top of the eighth off for the Aces. Tolles still on the mound.
That'd be something to see if he got 10 wins today. Just doesn't happen. It's just unthinkable. Good pitch there. Getting Hendricks off balance, throwing that little curveball slider, bottom of the zone. Missing low is always a good thing, especially with the off speed. You don't want to be hanging it. Racking up those punch outs. He's got to get to 43 now. He's got three just today. Amazing what he's doing this year. What a special year for him.
So Tolles again winds and delivers, and Wern has been super competitive.
Having a down year for him, but he's always a competitive guy. A mainstay in the ABL, playing here since I was in the league in 2009 or 10. 2010, 2011 year, yeah, I was playing in this league against Vern. And he's been hanging around. Good team guy. Loves his baseball. But yeah, struggling to get that average over the Mendoza line so far. Unfortunate to see. But that's baseball sometimes. Not every year is going to be your best year. Interesting to see the pitcher still throwing in the bullpen. This is Cody Buckle still throwing in the bullpen after pitching that inning. Maybe he's just trying to finish.
And gets
finish
one off the fist. Welsh comes and collects. Maddox with some good stretch and some good glove work. Accepts it. So Wern 5-3. Two out. So Darryl George with the high tops on and really cut loose on that one. Foul ball. Again, sinks a fastball outside low. 1-1. So Tolles again. Comes in and George fouls that one to his feet. So one ball, two strikes with two out. Top of the eighth. Aces by one. And there's a big breaking pitch left up and out. 2-2. Again, he comes round and he hoits that one round the corner and line waits. Makes a beautiful play from shortstop. Got a little bit of a tough bounce. Gathered, got it off quick. Makes the out. So bottom of the eighth on its way. Adelaide Bite chasing one. See you back in a moment.
Fast approaching, and so too is the Australian Baseball League Championship Series. Who will claim the shield in 2015? Find out live on ESPN and MLB Network.
Barber makes the call, it's all over, and the Perth Heat have done it.
Bottom of the eighth inning for your Adelaide Bites. Right fielder number 21, Ben Lodge.
It's Benny Lodge leading the bottom of the eighth off, and it's been a pretty tight ball game all the way through, and perhaps thinking at times that the Bite were ready to explode, but hasn't been, and Ace has just been able to continue to manage their way through here and flip their pitching around, and the Pens come to play today. Yeah, got a one-run lead.
Yeah, this Buckle has a live arm. Well, some of the years he's had 120 strikeouts in 96 innings pitching, only 27 base on balls. So when he got drafted as an 18-year-old out of Simi Valley, California, Royal High School, 72nd overall in the second round of the draft by the Texas Rangers. He was on the fast track to make it to the big leagues after his year in the Sal League and then his year in the Carolina League, where he had a 1.3 ERA, 75 innings pitched, 91 strikeouts. But something must have happened in between 2012, 2013, because he kind of lost it for a couple years. Hopefully for his sake he can find it, though, and looks like he is having a pretty successful season. One of the few bright spots for that Melbourne Aces bullpen, with an ERA under 3 and a not too bad win-loss ratio like some pitchers have. A lot of 0-6s or 0-5s I've seen, or 1-7s, 1-5s, but he's around 2-3 or something. He's hanging in there. It's going to be a tough task for the Bite here to come back against this pitcher. No one else is warming up in the bullpen, so it looks like he may ride it out for the Melbourne Aces. Certainly has the talent to do so.
Yes, as he fired one straight at the hands of Vocca, who popped it up. And just expertly handled there by Namada, just glove up to the sun, give him great vision. Knowing with the spin of the ball, always going to bring it back into the field of play. Just excellent judgment, it would have just about landed on the plate.
This guy's got to be throwing low to mid-90s as well. Good thing he wasn't in there when the Melbourne Aces decided to start throwing at a bunch of the Adelaide Bite batters, because this guy'd make it hurt.
So that one's just lifted, and Cousins just saw it straight off the bat. So a very cheap dig for the Aces there, just what they would have been asking for. Jump straight back into that batter's box and see if they can get an insurance run or two and seal this game 4. We'll see you back here in a moment.
At Hog's Breath, there's something we take very seriously. Delicious, tender steak, just how you like it. Slow cooked for 18 hours, the traditional prime rib steak is still king. Seriously great steak for serious steak lovers.
Ground ball back at the pitcher. Tola recovers and Canberra are the champions of Australian baseball.
The month of February is fast approaching, and so too is the Australian Baseball League Championship Series. Who will claim the shield in 2015? Find out live on ESPN and MLB Network.
Bible makes the call, it's all over, and the Perth Heat have done it.
And a pitching change for the Adelaide Bites, leaving the ball game is number 11, Josh Toll. He's replaced on the mound by number 27, Will Mathis. And of course, staying in the game as a catcher, number 30, Chris Adamson. Top of the ninth inning for the Melbourne Aces. Centre fielder number 23, Adam Engel.
Will Mathis replaces Josh Toles. Cody Buckle's gone straight to the bullpen to stay warm, stay hot. He didn't want to cool down at all. He's got that taste in his mouth and he wants this one, so he's looking like he's going to finish this one off for the Aces. Mathis comes in to relieve Toles, and Will's been pretty good all year, been a bit stiff here and there, but thought his last outing was his best outing. Thought nicely managed by Brook that he did his couple of digs and finished on a high and took him out.
Yeah, I got four strikeouts and two innings pitched. It was pretty impressive. He's got that kind of stuff, but just hasn't been able to put it together that much this year. He's got that ERA hovering around 7. And same amount of walks as strikeouts, which is that ratio you don't want to see. 21 strikeouts, 19 base on balls, and 27 innings pitched. Just doesn't strike enough guys out and walks too many guys. Not a good combination.
Yeah, an angle. Just a nice piece of hitting, just line drive, low line drive, straight to left field. Base hit to lead his team off. Top nine. So the Aces, they're feeling it.
Yeah, hopefully he can keep a positive attitude out there. A lot of times with the struggling pitcher, they give up one hit to lead off the inning and they get that feeling inside their head, oh, here we go again, I'm going to get rocked. But he should be able to bounce back. Not the most daunting lineup here with Melbourne Aces, and he's had success against them a couple days ago, so why not?
And a great attempt at a double play, but unfortunately, Corey, just with the momentum of the body.
That would have been a great double play for Mathis, pitcher's best friend, but instead, basically job done with the sack bunt. We got the runner on second with one out, throwing error by Corey Lyons, his third error of the day. Tough to see for the guy. But he's out there working. He doesn't have much shortstop experience. It's the toughest position on the field, as we were saying earlier, so what can you expect? Brooke put him out there, kind of trial by fire today. Give Dixon a day off. He's got a hit, got a walk, done okay. Made a few plays at shortstop, but the majority's let go by. It's a tough game.
Yeah, and this is picture perfect for the Aces. Got Harmon, the class act, to do the job. And if he can't get it done, see whether Deglan behind him. Well, not Deglan, sorry, he's out of the game. Dale is behind him. So this is probably the moment for the Aces to, for Harmon to clutch up, get a base hit somewhere and pick up Engel and give them a two-run lead. And Mathis tries outside and misses. So again, I think maybe the picture is clear that don't even bother about Brad Harmon. Just we won't throw the four fingers up and be that easy, but I don't want anything anywhere near the middle of the plate.
It's got to be tough for a guy like Harmon. He doesn't see that many pitches, and he's only hitting 220. It's like, when are they going to start throwing me those fastballs again? And he was never that superstar hitter in the minor leagues either, but he did make it to the big leagues as a solid, you know, utility middle infield guy. But he was always, you know, maybe two-hole hitter or five, six, seven-hole hitter. And he comes here, and everybody thinks he's, with that big league time he's had, everyone pitches him like he's Barry Bonds, and he's able to rack up a lot of walks, but just that average seems to dangle around at a lower level than he'd be happy with.
Oh, it's going to test Maddox, and it's...
Dixon's nowhere to be found. Mathis is nowhere to be found. Got to help yourself out sometimes.
Yeah, you sure do. That was a tough one, wasn't it? It's good effort by Maddox, because that was a run scored if that got through. So at the end of the day, even though it wasn't highly effective.
You got to be helping yourself out and covering first base there as a pitcher. I think no excuse for that, you know. It's a tough game, but you got to do the little things right, you know, work on those PFPs. Anything to the right side, you got to hustle over to first base and be there. And he didn't move till he saw that ball caught. As soon as that ball comes off the bat, you got to be sprinting full speed at first base. Kind of create your own luck sometimes, and he's put himself in a difficult situation here.
And even to see Ryan Dale there on the first pitch take a good hack at it. He's been a little bit in and out and up and down, but that looked a lot more confident, and certainly the endeavour was to accept the challenge and control it, let him control things instead of being controlled. So runners in the corners, one out, and Mathis starts it down the middle and tails it inside. Dale swings over it. One ball, two strikes. One out. Runners in the corners, top nine. Aces by one.
Dale's not much of a threat here for the Aces, unfortunately, with Deglan out. They're taking a loss here with having to bring Dale in, who's only about 18 years old, recently signed. Yep, by the Kansas City Royals. And getting a go here for the Aces on the weekend. These young guys out of Australia got to get as many at-bats as possible to be able to keep up with the Americans who've been playing 100 games a year since they're 2 years old, basically. Getting the experience here, but still only hitting 162. Looks like he's got all the tools, though. 191 centimeters, 82, 85 kilos, probably about 90 kilos. So looking like a big, strong young man.
Yeah, well, he's the son of the big, strong older man in Phil Dale, the ex-manager. Mm-hmm. And hot pitcher for Australia. Pitching coach for Australia. And there's a tough one along the line. It's going to take a bare hander. But good enough. A little slow roller along the third baseline scores a run. Happens in all different ways, all shapes and forms. But the Aces get one across with a single to five.
Gotta create your own luck there, though. Should have had two outs. And that could have been the last out of the inning, if not. And now he's getting himself in more of a jam. Two runners on, only one out. Getting to that middle, back end of the lineup here for the Aces. But that one mistake he made, not covering first base. kicking himself now. Got to get through this, though. He can do it.
Davies, and this is baseball. This is sort of, in some respect, what it's all about, is that we've been riding him a little, and not personally, just purely on what we're seeing. And but here we are, top nine, runner in scoring, and things can just all turn around, and he knocks one to centre right or something, and he chops one up the middle. Potential double play. Moon spins, and they make a great little double play. 6-4-3 with Moon on the other side of that one. But the Aces get another one across the plate, take a two-run lead into the bottom of the ninth, and it is now or never for the Adelaide Bite. See you back in a moment.
You all know what you have to do. Remember, no one, and I mean no one, comes into our house and pushes us around.
So, I want you to get up now. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs.
Things off in the bottom of the ninth inning for your Adelaide Bite, proudly supported by SA Power Networks. Shortstop number 32, Corey Lyon.
So Corey Lyon lead off the bottom of the ninth in do or die, and he shapes up to think I might bump my way on. At the end of the day, we need base runners, and as the lead off and the original lead off, that's what his job is to do, get on any way he can, and he puts a big swing on that, swings through, strike one. So 1-1 the count, bottom of the ninth, Bite chasing a couple, and he gets one, second base, and George didn't have many options but to try to smother that ball and hope that he could keep it in check and pick it up and get it to first before Lyon. But nice bit of work there by Corey.
Base runners anyway, anyhow. It looked like he took a hard swing at that ball and it didn't jump off the bat as hard as you think it would. Probably some funky spin on it. Might have caught it off the end of the bat there, and that's what George had to deal with. Ended up being a tough hop. Jumped up right in his guts, and he put it down on the ground. Blocked it off to the side, and Corey's quick enough to get there. Just what the Bite needed, anyway, anyhow. Get that leadoff runner on. Let's see how aggressive Brooks is going to be here. It doesn't look like he's bunting. He wants to win it. He don't want to sit around and have a tie ball game. He wants two runs this inning all the way. Six, four. Okay, yeah, I thought it was 5-4.
So
need two runs. Yeah, bunt's not going to do anything here. Need more than a couple base runners. It'll be interesting to see if they bunt Welchie if Chan Moon gets on. Brooke does like to small ball it, and sometimes the old adage is, when you're home, you play for the tie. When you're away, you play for the win. Oh!
Oh, nicely umbrellaed down the foul territory down there, but just having trouble getting a handle on it. But swinging Moon around to the left side, that he certainly feels a lot more comfortable, and ripped that one foul. And that one bounced on the plate. Nicely done there by Namata, because it's all inches and little things now. That ball evades Namata, and that puts Lyon to second comfortably, instead of the Adelaide Bite having to get him there some shape or form. And Moon swings over that one and strikes out. So nice pitch there by Buckle, and he's, you could see, even with his intent going straight to the pen after his last, he wants this.
That's interesting to see from an American style pitcher. The guy's going to the pen. That's usually what Japanese or Korean guys do. They throw the whole game. So they finish an inning and they go over on the side and just keep throwing, keep the arm loose. And maybe with those crazy walk numbers he's had before, there might be an injury involved somewhere. It looks like it, and they're trying to rehab him from that. And he may tighten up real quick, and he's trying to stay loose. Very rarely do you see that with American pitchers. Both innings he went over there and got on the bullpen and kept throwing. Doesn't want to let it freeze up, tighten up on him.
These are the sorts of moments that the Adelaide Bite have lived off a little bit. Had a habit of winning these games. But today, seemingly easier said than done. It's Buckle is feeling it.
Not sure what that off-speed pitch he struck Moon out on was, if it was a slider or a splitter or a changeup. But the way that fastball explodes out of his hand, anything off-speed is going to be tough to sit back on. Well, she knew that one.
Really pulled the string on that one, and Welsh just became a spectator for a moment and watched it across the plate, knew immediately, just in his very nice style, just tucked the bat under the arm and headed off. Two out. Gets one off the handle. Davey sits and takes, and the Melbourne Aces get the job done here in game four. A solid performance by them, based around a good team effort from all boys. So well done to the Melbourne Aces. They needed a little pick-me-up, and they got it. But at the end of the day, it's been a great weekend for the Adelaide Bite. They took their three games, and with last night's victory, it sealed them their top spot. Might have been a little ho-hum day at the office for them. They're going to have to regroup, get that strength back, and head off to Melbourne midweek and see what they can do in the last series in Melbourne. So from the 10th inning team, that's the last you'll hear of us this season. We've enjoyed bringing everything to you from Jim Manning, Peter Wyatt, Andrew Sperling. Who else we got here? We got Johnny Russell, Chappie, and our fantastic commentary team, Jamie McCohen today. We've had Burke Weber, Ian Revel, Mark Haylock, Don Wolf. We've had a whole heap of guys, and everyone here voluntary, just wanting to do it to bring baseball to the people. So from the 10th inning team, it's been a wonderful season, and we've loved every minute bringing it to you. We'll see you next time. Take care. See you back here in a few weeks for the big playoff. We'll see you then.